police video of a medical scare in a high school cafeteria. Deputy Pedro Colon performing CPR for several minutes after a student suffered a seizure and collapsed. The teen, recovering and alert, sat up until paramedics took him to the hospital. That student then returned to the school, showing gratitude to the deputy in person. Dueling town halls, what would have been the second debate tonight, will be separate events on separate networks happening at the same time. President Trump and Vice President Biden less than an hour away from facing off, but not directly against each other after President Trump withdrew. Senator Kamala Harris halting travel after two of her campaign staffers tested positive for coronavirus. And the stunning comment from Republican Senator Lindsey Graham today about the presidential election.
Thank you for acknowledging that.
Yeah, I think it's true.
The third surge has arrived, according to the COVID tracking project, as 14 states are now seeing an increase in the number of daily deaths. Hospitalizations are on the rise across three dozen states. And why Dr. Anthony Fauci had this to say today.
So I think that we just got to look that square in the eye and say it's nonsense.
The crackdown in Europe as the COVID cases there surge, curfews going into effect in several major cities, including Paris, all indoor gatherings in London banned. And we take you to the European country with the highest rate of infections in Europe, as many there admit they declared victory over the virus too soon. Fallout over the lack of a stimulus. Our Rebecca Jarvis speaks with a leading economist about the devastation that could be on the way if Congress fails to make a deal. Seeking justice, the new details in the death of Ronald Green. Police originally said he died in a car accident, but newly obtained audio from the body camera suggests a much different story. Green's family joins us tonight. And while President Trump responds to the threat of climate change by saying we have the cleanest air and water, tonight, a reality check, how rising sea levels can affect our water quality.
Those septics are just spewing wastewater into our groundwater. So whatever goes into our groundwater goes into our bay. And that's pretty disgusting.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Lindsay Davis. Thanks so much for streaming with us. By and large, 2020 has not played out like many thought it would. And the same is also true of the second presidential debate. Consider it social distancing on steroids. While both candidates are making their case on the national stage tonight, those stages are in different venues, in different states, on different networks. This is the trickle-down effect of the president getting coronavirus. He's since recovered, but he withdrew from the head-to-head debate when he learned that the town hall would be virtual because of his initial diagnosis. Joe Biden then made his own plans, and here we are. The former vice president will speak to voters in an ABC News town hall that begins right after the show. Here's a live look at the stage there tonight in Philadelphia. The president's competing event was finalized just yesterday, and all of this comes as Senator Kamala Harris is halting travel after she had contact with two people who tested positive for COVID, one of them a close aide. And across the country, the coronavirus is showing no signs of slowing down. We're now approaching 8 million cases, and we are just 19 days away from the election. We begin with Mary Bruce on the dueling town halls.
With COVID cases on the rise around the country, President Trump today touching down in North Carolina, which just reported its highest single-day increase since March. But the president argues everything is getting back to normal.
I mean, the people want to get back. The kids want to be back in school. My Baron, my tall Baron, he's very tall. My beautiful Baron, handsome, he is handsome. But my beautiful Baron had it, he recovered like so fast.
Today, few masks in the president's crowd. On GMA, Dr. Anthony Fauci said, that's a big problem.
When you have a high community spread, particularly when people are not wearing masks, is not a good thing. That's a high-risk endeavor.
The president is increasingly attacking Fauci, the nation's top expert on infectious diseases.
He said, this is not a threat, this is not a problem, don't worry about this, not that one's a problem, it's the craziest thing. But he's a nice guy, so I keep him around, right? We'll keep him around.
Joe Biden is eager to highlight his campaign's different approach to the pandemic. Today, aides announcing his running mate Kamala Harris is off the campaign trail through this weekend after two people on her team tested positive. Harris had not been in close contact with either of them. Biden himself off the trail today, but Trump is ramping up his rallies, spending time in red states he won in 2016.
Hello, Des Moines. Oh, it's been a good time we've had.
Trump's been pleading with a key voting bloc, women, to support him.
Suburban women, will you please like me? Remember? Please. Please. I saved your damn neighborhood, okay?
Today, he says he's given female voters what they want.
You know what women want? More than anything else, they want safety, security, and they want to be able to have their houses and leave me alone, right? The suburban woman.
But 4 years later, he's still taking shots at his former rival, the first woman nominated by a major party.
And they talked about the glass ceiling, right? The woman breaking the glass ceiling. And it didn't work out that way. The glass ceiling broke her, but there will be a woman that breaks the glass ceiling. It just won't be Hillary.
President Trump still thinking about his 2016 opponent. Mary Bruce joins us now from Philadelphia. Of course, this was not the head-to-head town hall that many were anticipating tonight. But what are you hearing from the Biden campaign as far as what he's hoping to accomplish tonight?
Well, Lindsay, in many ways, Joe Biden's goal for these next 19 days is simply to do no harm. He likes the fact that President Trump is soaking up a lot of the oxygen. They think that's good for the Biden campaign. But despite the fact that Joe Biden is up in national polls, his team isn't taking anything for granted. In fact, his campaign manager summing it up in a tweet, writing, "There is still a long way to go in this campaign, and we think this race is far closer than folks on Twitter think," adding, "like a lot closer." Lindsay.
And we even heard some interesting comments from Senate Republicans today seeming to acknowledge that the president could lose, including the president's close ally, Lindsey Graham.
Lindsay, this was a very rare admission from Lindsey Graham, one of the president's, arguably his closest ally on Capitol Hill. Lindsey Graham today saying, quote, "The Democrats have a good chance of winning the White House," even doubling down later and saying, "I think it's true." And today there were also some other really surprising, stunning comments from another Senate Republican, Senator Ben Sasse of Nebraska. He was caught on a call with supporters, basically just ripping into the president, saying that he has flirted with white supremacists, that he's treated the president like a business opportunity, also criticizing the president's handling of the coronavirus. It went on and on and on. Some rare, blunt comments from Republicans on the Hill today.
Mary Bruce for us in Philadelphia. Thanks so much, Mary. And another reminder, the special edition of 2020 ABC News Town Hall with Biden begins right after this newscast. George Stephanopoulos with questions from voters tonight at 8 right here on ABC News Live. One of the big issues that we can expect to be discussed tonight is, of course, the pandemic, especially with this country now seeing a surge in cases across 38 states. A third person in the U.S. now confirmed to have been reinfected with the virus as we approach 60,000 cases daily nationwide. And tonight, news on your blood type and the virus. ABC's Marcus Moore reports in from Oklahoma City.
Researchers say a man in Seattle tonight is the third known person in the U.S. to have been infected twice with coronavirus. The nursing home resident in his 60s spent 40 days in the hospital this spring before testing negative multiple times, only to get sick with COVID again 5 months later. Researchers saying reinfections like this are considered rare. It comes amidst the fall surge, doctors sounding the alarm. At Integris Health in Oklahoma City, they've run out of ICU beds.
It's challenging. It's the same thing over and over again, dealing with very, very sick patients. It's tough for families, it's tough for staff, it's tough for doctors, it's tough for nurses. And people are tired.
Cases now climbing in 38 states, hospitalizations rising in 36, and tonight the CDC forecasting up to 240,000 deaths by November 7th. With colder weather, doctors are seeing more indoor spread. Wisconsin's governor urging people to stay home or wear a mask when going out.
This is becoming life and death for folks in the state of Wisconsin.
El Paso, Texas today, tightening restrictions after cases and hospitalizations hit an all-time high.
This is an unprecedented amount of new cases, which require immediate action in order to slow the spread.
Funeral homes here preparing for the worst, adding walk-in refrigerators that can hold up to 20 bodies each.
It's hard to see people's loved ones passing away alone, and hearing that from the family that, you know, they wish they could have been there at their last moments.
In California, Ben Fontanilla is burying his wife Sally today. They worked at the same hospital. He wants people to know his wife was devoted to her patients battling COVID.
I want them to know that it affects everybody, especially those who take care of them in the hospital.
Tonight, new research suggesting blood type could be associated with COVID risk. Type O blood may make a person less likely to be infected and less likely to develop severe illness. cause, although experts say more research is needed if blood type does make a difference and why.
So blood type even playing a factor here as well. Marcus Morin joins us now from Oklahoma City, where he's been speaking with the medical staff there. Marcus, tell us more about some of these challenges that they're facing right now and really expected to face as we head into colder months.
Well, Lindsay, I am just outside the busiest ER here in the state of Oklahoma, and so they are still treating the heart attacks and the car accident patients who come in, and what they are most concerned about going into the days ahead is the continued number of cases of COVID-19. They are out of ICU beds here, and their other concern, along with the patients, the general public here, is that their doctors and their nurses and respiratory therapists themselves could end up sick and needing treatment. And so as we look ahead to the days and weeks ahead and we get into flu season, they are certainly preparing for a very busy time ahead.
And Marcus, as Americans plan their Thanksgiving holidays, we got another reminder today about the reality of testing and why it isn't a guarantee that will keep you and your family safe.
Yeah, Lindsay, we heard from the admiral, who's actually the testing coordinator for the Trump administration. He did a recent interview with our Devin Dwyer, and he basically said that families cannot rely on testing for the holiday. They anticipate that a lot of people across this country will be going to their relatives' homes to celebrate Thanksgiving, and that perhaps they may try to pre-screen, get a test before going. But they say there's no guarantee because you could be negative one day and end up developing COVID-19 symptoms the next day or even the day after that, because there is an incubation period. So that's what they're trying to caution people about as we enter the holiday season.
Right. No guarantee. All right, Marcus Moore, thanks to you. And turning overseas now, France has declared a public health emergency. The British government is issuing tougher restrictions in London and in Eastern Europe. The ICUs are filling up. But unlike here in America, for a time this summer, Europe believed that the virus was contained. As Ian Pannell reports, that belief is now all in the past.
A dinner party for the ages. It was the end of June. The lockdowns were lifting, and the Czech Republic was hailed by the rest of Europe for successfully stopping the virus. It had been a grueling few weeks, so Andrej Kobizar wanted to celebrate his country's newfound freedom.
I made idea and ask politicians if I can do this action, invite people to sit to the long table, and they said okay. In that time it was a really calm situation.
1600 foot long table on Prague's famous Charles Bridge was center stage. People gathered, happy, finally carefree.
The rules was that everybody can come, but he has to bring something to drink or to eat and to offer to your neighbor.
The country of 10 million had managed to avoid the full brunt of the first wave, with fewer than 12,000 infections and 350 deaths. But it was too soon to declare victory. People left their homes. They went back to work. And then the virus struck back. Cases have steadily climbed with no sign it's easing.
Now it's becoming serious.
Today, the Czech Republic has more COVID infections per capita than any other country in Europe. For now, hospitals are coping, but officials are scrambling to reverse course, the Prime Minister making this stunning admission of fault.
Even I got carried away by the upcoming summer and the atmosphere in society. That was a mistake I do not want to repeat.
Its health minister resigned last month. And now, like so much of Europe, the Czech Republic is desperately trying to hold back the tide when all around them is water. Schools, restaurants and bars closed again. Officials rapidly pulling the plug on reopenings as a fierce second wave sweeps across the continent, with nearly 100,000 cases a day in the last week. Alinka Budnik is a chef in the Czech capital, Prague. She's had to get creative. These COVID cakes have been flying off the shelves. Ironically, they're helping her business survive.
With the Corona cake, we are trying to stay afloat, so we are doing what we can. People are interested in it, so that's the positive side of the coronavirus.
But the negative side's growing. anger and resistance to shutdown measures is now widespread as cooler weather sets in. A critical period that medical professionals had warned could be dire if people didn't follow the rules.
Of course, coronavirus is very dangerous, but I think more dangerous is fear.
And just look at this. Liverpool, England, and The Hague, the Netherlands. No masks, no distance, not a care in the world. But it isn't the young who party who are at greatest risk, it's those they go on to infect. Relatives, neighbours, colleagues, and there are real fears that scenes like this will push hospitals to the brink. The Hague Council now looking to prosecute partygoers there. And in Liverpool, an uptick in the city's hospitalisations, with ICUs in northwest England getting full.
I know how far I can breathe at the minute, and I know I can't survive without this.
President Emmanuel Macron imposing curfews in 9 major French cities.
We need total confinement. Can you please explain how keeping people at home from 9 p.m. to 6 a.m. is going to help the situation?
From France to Holland, from Britain to the Czech Republic, coronavirus is raging once more across Europe. And the fact that it was once contained across the continent this summer stands as a warning to America and others as to what a second wave could look like as winter closes in. Ian Pannell for ABC News Live.
Our thanks to Ian for that. The pandemic is also continuing to take a toll on the American economy. Nearly 900,000 more Americans filed new unemployment claims last week, the 30th straight week of historically high claims. And overall, more than 25 million Americans are receiving jobless benefits. But Washington remains deadlocked over providing more much-needed economic stimulus, the roller coaster of negotiations going nowhere fast, with little sign of a deal before Election Day. Here's ABC's chief business and economics correspondent, Rebecca Jarvis.
With Washington at a stalemate over plans for a new round of stimulus to fight the devastating consequences of the pandemic,
I'd say at this point, getting something done before the election and executing on that would be difficult, just given where we are.
Don't let the perfect be the enemy of the good, as they say.
It is nowhere near perfect.
Madam Speaker.
Always the case, but we're not even close to the good.
The economic recovery facing increasing pressure. Rehiring slowing, layoffs rising, 898,000 more Americans filing new claims for unemployment last week, and now more than 8 million people have fallen into poverty since the start of the crisis.
11 million people who lost their jobs during the pandemic still don't have them back. How important is stimulus from Washington right now?
It's critical. It's nothing short of critical. These households, 11 million people who, for no fault of their own, have lost their jobs, their livelihoods, and lay awake probably every night wondering how they're going to take care of themselves. They need additional bridge, if you will, to get them through the pandemic and ready to go back to work when jobs are available.
In an exclusive interview with ABC News, Mary Daly, the president of the Federal Reserve Bank of San Francisco, calling on Congress to get a deal done now.
What happens if Washington doesn't come through with stimulus soon?
It's going to be a drawn-out recovery. I don't want to take another decade to recover like we did after the financial crisis. That was
Daly joining a growing list of economists, including Fed Chair Jerome Powell, who say failure to act now puts the recovery at risk and deepens the despair.
Ultimately, we live in an economic system that's quite integrated. And when one of us struggles, all of us tumble. And it's really something we have to take to heart. We are interconnected. So every day we wait is one day too long.
Lorena Cantaravisi, who started her restaurant Maria Empanada in Denver, Colorado, 9 years ago, is one of the many desperately waiting.
I started my business with $300 and no word in English when I came to this country. And now, pre-COVID, we had 5 locations. We were employing 70 families, and we were part of the economy and a business that was blooming and growing.
When COVID hit, Lorena was forced to close 3 locations and laid off 60% of her team. Sales have started to pick up, but are nowhere near pre-pandemic levels. And without help from the government, she says her business is at risk.
as a small business owners, we don't have the luxury of deciding when we can pay rent or when we can pay payroll.
And what do you say to someone who says, well, Lorena, just go to your bank, get a loan from your bank?
We are also in an industry that is very normally hard to get a normal loan. Restaurants is very normal that they crash in the first 6 months or 3 years. Investors, they don't want to invest at this time. Banks, they don't want to loan at this time.
Considering how high the stakes are right now, would the Fed ever consider cutting checks directly to the American people?
We have lending powers, not spending powers. In 1913, when they put the Fed together, they said, you can control the interest rate. That's your main tool. That's your only real tool to manage the economy. And Congress makes those spending decisions. So it really is up to Congress. And, you know, the thing that I keep going back to is we've been able to put a man on the moon repeatedly. I think we can get this done. And the American people depend on us.
The Fed has signaled it expects to keep interest rates near zero for the next 3 years and has additionally pledged to do whatever it takes to boost lending, committing trillions of dollars to purchasing corporate debt, mortgage-backed securities, and treasuries.
Is there frustration inside the Fed that here we are, we've thrown trillions of dollars, an unprecedented amount of stimulus at this problem, and Washington has been at a stalemate for months while more people are losing their jobs, the rehiring is slowing down, and at least some of the progress that was made earlier in the summer appears to be stalling or not existent anymore?
Well, when I'm faced with a hard problem, you have two choices. You can get frustrated or you can get busy.
As for Lorena, she says she will also stay busy, fighting to keep the doors of Maria Empanada open.
Having a business that is being closed is not just that you close the door of a restaurant. You are killing a dream at the same time. You are killing effort that you are putting in all these years.
Our thanks to Rebecca for that. And when we come back, the heartbreaking plea. The grandfather who lost his grip on his 18-month-old grandchild on a cruise ship has his day in court. She fell out of a window that he didn't realize was open. We're tracking new developments in the alleged plot to kidnap the governor of Michigan. But up next, the police report into the death of this man, Ronald Green, said one thing, but the words of the lead officer on the scene said another. And tonight, a family is demanding justice. We'll speak with them next.
Welcome to Disney Plus. Are you ready? Drop in and explore the action, the adventure, and the originals. There's no limit to what you'll find. These are your worlds. So come on, dive deeper into the universes you love. Wherever and whenever you want them, you'll find them all here on Disney Plus.
With so much at stake, so much on the line, more Americans turn here than any place else. ABC News World News Tonight with David Muir.
We have made it through another week together.
America's most watched program across all of television.
Cross my office off the list.
What if we take for each other?
Please stop. I feel something when I see you.
Hello?
This is Montana Highway Patrol. You're looking for a couple of missing teenagers.
That's right. Last seen in a red Focus.
The steering wheel is getting stiff.
Lock the door. We're fine.
No, I won't. Be afraid.
Got ourselves a predicament.
When the night.
Welcome back. Tonight, the family of a Louisiana man is calling for justice after new explosive audio that the Associated Press says was obtained from body camera footage. That audio is now putting the death of Ronald Green in the spotlight. Green died at the end of May in a 2019 car chase in northern Louisiana. Green's family was initially told by officials that the 49-year-old died from injuries suffered in a car crash into a tree shrub at the end of a long chase that began over an unspecified traffic violation. The family is disputing the account from state police, which omits any reference to troopers using force. They've released photos too graphic to show of Green's body, appearing to show deep bruises on his face and cuts on his scalp. Photos of the car that he was driving show it only had minor damage. ABC News has obtained the audio from the body camera microphone of State Trooper Chris Hollingsworth. Authorities say that that video will not be released while there is an active investigation going on. We do have to warn you, the audio is graphic and disturbing. Trooper that you just heard there, Chris Hollingsworth, he died in late September after a single car accident on the very same day he was informed that he was being fired for his role in this incident. These are images from his funeral. Hollingsworth was the only one of six troopers placed on administrative leave following an administrative investigation of the incident not opened until this August. Now the subject of a federal civil rights investigation, and tonight there are growing calls for authorities to release the full body camera video. Joining us now is Ronald Green's mother, Mona Hardin, his sister, Danelle Hardin, and the family's attorney, Lee Merritt. They have all filed a wrongful death lawsuit. Thank you all for your time. And Ms. Hardin, to say that we are sorry for your loss, of course, falls so short and comes very late. As you know, this case has gotten very little national attention until now. Now, you all recently met with the governor of Louisiana. You've both seen body camera video of the incident. We just heard that disturbing audio. Ms. Hardin, walk us through what you saw. And did you receive assurances that this video will be made public and soon?
What I did see, I can tell you, is totally what was told to us, that he was in an accident, he died in a car crash because of this accident. This video tells a whole different tape. His death certificate and this video is two different stories. It's horrific. I can't close my eyes and not see my son and what they did to him. I find it hard to sleep. It's been almost a year and a half. It was hard before. It's even harder now. It's unbelievable that this has gone this long, but I can see why it hasn't been revealed, because it's another story here. It's horrendous what happened to my son, and the fact that this has been kept under wraps, and the fact that they were going to keep it under wraps because they thought that we would not do anything with this. They just thought that this was going to be another death, another murder that they got away with. And that's how I see it.
But
that's
how I see it. What happened to your son? For families who are just hearing about this story for the first time, you obviously know this information really well. But based on what you saw in the video, can you relay to us all what did happen to him?
I will say that relaying what happened in that video for this family will probably be very difficult. I can say that as the vehicles came to a stop, Ronald Green immediately surrendered with his hands up, and he told law enforcement that he was sorry. He actually kept repeating that he was sorry and that he was scared. Without much time, the law enforcement officers approached the vehicle shouting obscenities. They immediately tased Ronald and drug him from the car. That was a matter of seconds by the time that they approached the vehicle. Once they had him on the ground, Officer Chris Hollingsworth put him in a chokehold while the other officers, at least one other officer, and I'm not sure which officer, tased him at that point a second time and a third time as he was. Christopher Hollingsworth continued to shout, "Put your arms behind your back," but he made it impossible because of the chokehold that he was placing him in while repeatedly tasing him. While that was going on, the men continued to shout obscenities and insults for about 4 minutes, sustained minutes of beating and choking. before they put him in handcuffs. Once they placed him in handcuffs, the beating continued.
Yes.
And the choking continued until they stopped for a brief moment to wash their hands of his blood. And then they returned to him to put shackles on his feet. They mocked him. They stomped on him. They drug him by his feet, the chains that they attached to his feet for no apparent reason, just for sport. And then they laughed about it.
You're saying that they literally washed their hands of his blood. I want to fast forward for a second, Lee, and just get a sense of, were you surprised when you heard the graphic audio recording from that officer? And what do you think needs to happen next?
We were surprised when we heard the graphic audio, but after seeing the video and seeing that the behavior matched that audio, we know that there are additional officers who need to be arrested. They should have been arrested when this video was shared with the supervisors, and so there should be an investigation to why those supervisors or whoever were responsible, the stopgap for this kind of thing happening, why when they saw it, why weren't these men fired? The family is extremely disappointed that after seeing this video that they won't have the opportunity to see Christopher Hollingsworth prosecuted. Yes. But we certainly want to see the other two officers prosecuted.
Yes, we do.
Danielle, a question for you. When you first heard that your brother had passed away, at what point did you realize that there might be more to his death than authorities were telling you?
You know, I just feel like, based on the information that they gave us, it wasn't until we received a notification saying that on Facebook, the neighbor posted that he died, you know, right in my neighbor's driveway. And that's when we figured there was more to the story, that he was actually beaten and not in a car accident.
When we first heard that Ronnie died and was in a, died because of a car accident, we immediately went to Louisiana. We stayed there a total of 9 days, and we had no cooperation. It was also those 9 days where we did have no cooperation, no communication with none of the police, no state troopers, anything. And it was a back and forth. They just ran us in circles. We couldn't talk to no one, and no one called us.
Lee, have you received any explanation as far as why this investigation is taking so long?
Well, the DA who was initially responsible from Union Parish said that he immediately acknowledged that these were civil rights violations and should be referred over to the Department of Justice and to the FBI. He says since he referred it back in 2019, the case has just laid in wait.
Ms. Hardin, of course, this year has been extremely difficult for so many, the so-called racial reckoning in our country, spurring protests and some amount of reform. You've been calling for justice for your son for more than a year now. Of course, there have been similar calls for justice for Breonna Taylor, George Floyd, Jacob Blake, and the list goes on. Many of those calls, as you know, have gone unanswered. Do you have any advice for other grieving families? What's getting you through this time, and what do you hope for now?
What I can say is how it's so bittersweet, but it's the networking and communicating with so many families. We understand each other's grief, our loss. We totally connect. I hate using that description, but when people usually say, "I'm so sorry for your loss," it doesn't resonate on any level. But when immediately you meet these families who've endured this kind of pain and horrific situations that goes on with their loved ones, it's an unspoken bond that happens. And for me, I found that it lightens the burden on me. I have someone I can talk to and relate to. And all I can say is the networking. And keep the network with positive energy, positive people. It's unbelievable, the fact that here we are almost a year and a half later, and the thoughts and everything on this is, it goes right back to day one. It's like I haven't awakened from this bad dream.
a nightmare, I'm sure. Mona,
yes,
and Danelle
really.
Hardin, Lee Merritt, we thank you so much for your time and for talking with us and sharing your son and
thank
brother's
you so
story.
Much. Thank you for having us. Thank you. It's much appreciated.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you.
And still ahead here on Prime, the burning car, the people trapped inside, and the dramatic rescue all caught on police body cam. The Postal Service settling a lawsuit, what it means for the many expected to vote by mail. It's our ballot watch tonight. And speaking of voting, why race may impact how long you may have to wait in line to vote. We take a look by the numbers. But first, our tweet of the day, singer Sam Smith with this important message.
Mornings may look different these days, but where you start your day,
where you spend your mornings, where you get connected to everything that's happening.
And face it, there's a whole lot happening in our world these days.
Where you get all the breaking new information of the day to help you navigate through these times.
That's why we're here.
Good morning, sunshine.
And making sure you start your day off with a smile and some sunshine.
Good morning, America.
Good morning, America.
Good morning, America. Oh, how I love saying that.
Hello?
This is Montana Highway Patrol. You're looking for a couple of missing teenagers.
That's right. When the night last seen in a red Focus. Has
come. The steering wheel is getting stiff.
Lock the door. We're fine.
No, I won't be afraid. Be afraid. Be afraid.
Got ourselves a predicament.
When the night has come.
The team with the highest card total could be leaving with $100,000.
To shop.
Bam, bam, bam.
Till you drop.
Oh, mommy down.
Leslie Jones hosts Supermarket Sweep. Premieres Sunday, October 18th on ABC.
Welcome back, everybody. We turn now to early voting now underway across the country with weeks to go before Election Day. We're already seeing hours-long lines at some polling sites. And tonight we examine how race might determine how long you'll have to wait to exercise your right to vote by the numbers. This week, some voters waited in line up to 8 hours to vote, according to the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights, which tracked particularly long lines in Texas, Georgia, and North Carolina. In Gwinnett County, Georgia, voters waited up to 2.5 hours to vote. But wait times vary widely. In Ohio, some counties have 97 times more polling places per voter than others, according to an analysis by The Guardian. 19 minutes was the average time voters spent at the polls, including in line during the 2016 presidential election. But wait times were 29% longer in entirely black neighborhoods than they were in entirely white neighborhoods in 2016. And voters in black neighborhoods were 74% more likely to wait more than 30 minutes at polling sites than those in white neighborhoods. And we still have lots to get to here on Prime. It's an unlikely battleground, the largest retirement community in Florida. Could the president be in trouble in this must-win state? The red flag warnings now up again across several states and the new evacuations underway in California. And our Ginger Z shows us how sea level rise could impact water quality in this week's It's Not Too Late. But first, a look at our top trending stories on abcnews.com.
Welcome to Disney Plus. Are you ready? Drop in and explore the action, the adventure, and the originals. There's no limit to what you'll find. These are your worlds. So come on, dive deeper into the universes you love, wherever and whenever you want them. You'll find them all here on Disney Plus.
COVID-19 was a wake-up call. There are so many more pandemics that could be just around the corner. Viruses literally travel through human populations. What we've got to do is go to those places where the virus begins its journey. Masks on?
Yep.
Masks on.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my God.
This is the exact way in which a new virus could start.
Virus Hunters, special event Sunday, November 1st at 9 on National Geographic.
With so much at stake, so much on the line, more Americans turn here than any place else. ABC News, World News Tonight with David Muir.
We have made it through another week together.
America's most watched program across all of television. It's being called the most consequential election of a lifetime, the most important vote. And with so much on the line, it demands the most straightforward, newsmaking, real answers, the most informed voices from all sides. The countdown is on to the vote. What will our future look like? ABC's This Week with George. It all plays out right here every Sunday.
The most consequential week yet of this hyper-political year.
Right as you get closer to casting your vote every Sunday on ABC.
Admit it. These days, what you need to know seems to change, well, like every day. So what can help you feel smarter, better, happier? Welcome to GMA3, What You Need to Know, the third hour of Good Morning America, lunchtime on ABC.
A surge of COVID-19 cases as we head into cooler weather.
It's quite concerning that we have a baseline of daily infections at approximately 45, 50,000 per day.
38 states plus Washington, D.C. seeing a rising number of new cases, and 6 states setting records for hospitalizations. Several funeral homes in El Paso, Texas, adding extra mortuary refrigerators.
So that way we have enough capacity to hold all the deaths that are happening here in El Paso.
Meantime, the Trump administration has reportedly embraced the unsupported idea of herd immunity, which would allow the coronavirus to spread among young, healthy people while protecting the vulnerable.
So this idea that we have the power to protect the vulnerable is total nonsense. You'll wind up with many more infections of vulnerable people, which will lead to hospitalizations and death.
Kamala Harris has canceled all travel through the weekend after her communications director and a flight crew member tested positive for coronavirus. Harris herself testing negative today, and she tweeted she was not in close contact with either person 2 days prior to their positive test. She's going to hold a virtual event tonight in North Carolina.
Europe also facing a surge. Spain and Italy seeing record numbers of new cases.
New charges in that alleged kidnapping plot targeting Michigan's Governor Gretchen Whitmer. The state's attorney general charging a 51-year-old man from Wisconsin with helping in an act of terror. That brings the total number of state and federal defendants in the case to 14 people. This latest defendant allegedly helped surveil the governor's home with a dash cam and night vision goggles.
I can't give you more information, but I can tell you that our investigation is ongoing.
Authorities claim the planning was months in the making. According to the FBI, the men were apparently angry because of Governor Whitmer's restrictions during the coronavirus pandemic, including those on gyms.
On Capitol Hill, the Senate Judiciary Committee has wrapped up 4 days of confirmation hearings for Supreme Court nominee Amy Coney Barrett.
In your hearts, you know that what's happening here is not right. It's not normal.
Members of the Senate Judiciary Committee voted against a motion introduced by Blumenthal to postpone the consideration of Judge Amy Coney Barrett's nomination until after Election Day. Committee members will vote on her nomination next week. A full Senate vote could take place before the election.
Red flag warnings across several states. Flames forcing dozens of evacuations tonight near Redlands, California. And Colorado's Cameron Peak Fire exploding in size. Now the largest wildfire in Colorado state history.
And when this wind event blew up, we just knew it was over.
This makes it extremely challenging for our firefighters, especially right now where it's most active.
A scary close call caught on police body cam. Albuquerque police responded to this compact car actively burning. Both passengers stuck. The fire extinguishers not effective. Their time limited, officers cut the seatbelts and pulled the passengers out to safety. Police reportedly say speeding played a part in the crash, but that there were no serious injuries.
Do you love bacon? If so, there is a new face mask for you. Hormel Foods has now created what it calls black label breathable bacon. Sound tasty? I'm not sure about that one. According to the company, the limited edition mask uses the latest in pork-scented technology. They're giving the mask away online now through October 28th. No word on whether the masks will be sold after the giveaway.
You will likely remember the heartbreaking story of the toddler who fell to her death from a cruise ship while her grandfather was holding her. Well, he says it was an accident. His family has stood by him from the very beginning. Authorities charged him with negligent homicide, and today he pled guilty. Ariel Reshef explains why.
Tonight, the grandfather who lost grip of his 18-month-old granddaughter on a cruise ship, making the gut-wrenching decision, pleading guilty to negligent homicide in her death, saying he just wants to help end part of this nightmare for his family. Sam Anello holding little Chloe Wiegand when she plummeted from this 11th-floor Royal Caribbean cruise ship window in San Juan, Puerto Rico in July of 2019.
To lose our baby this way is just unfathomable.
The toddler's parents standing by her grandfather. Anello always maintaining it was a grave accident, that he didn't realize the ship's window was open.
I sit here broken, and we all sit here broken, but our family is strong, and we will stay strong together.
But unreleased surveillance video seen by ABC News appears to show Anello look over the railing through the open window. Anello then picks up Chloe, and they appear to lean over together before she disappears from frame. Tonight, the family's attorney telling ABC News because the plea agreement includes no jail time and no admission of facts, it was decided the plea deal is in the best interests of the family so that they can close this horrible chapter and turn their focus to mourning Chloe.
And Lindsay, Chloe's family is suing Royal Caribbean for negligence, but while the cruise line disputes that lawsuit, tonight they say their thoughts are with the family during this difficult time. Lindsay.
Our thanks to Ariel. And now to tonight's Ballot Watch. And news that the U.S. Postal Service has agreed to reverse changes that had slowed down mail service nationwide. The Postal Service settling a lawsuit filed by Montana's governor that argued that changes implemented by the Postal Service over the summer had harmed access to mail services, leading to delayed deliveries of crucial mail and hurting the ability of people to vote by mail during the pandemic, when a record number of Americans are expected to cast their ballots by mail. You might remember embattled Postmaster General Louis DeJoy being grilled on Capitol Hill over the changes, which included removing collection boxes and mail sorting machines, closing and consolidating some processing facilities, as well as restricting extra trips and overtime for postal workers. Well, the changes had been temporarily blocked by a federal judge in September, and with this new settlement, many of those Postal Service changes will be reversed. But while no more sorting machines will be removed, don't expect them all back in action. The Postal Service has said that some have been dismantled and stripped for parts. As for your election ballot, under the agreement, the Postal Service will be required to prioritize election mail in the coming weeks. Some welcome news, certainly, but remember to still drop that ballot in the mail early to make sure it's delivered on time, or consider delivering it to the proper location in person. And now to an unlikely battleground in the 2020 election, the Villages in Florida, the largest retirement community in the country. It's normally a reliable Republican bastion, but President Trump has lost ground with seniors who he easily won over in 2016, and that could have major consequences in the must-win state of Florida. ABC's Victor Rakendo is there and files this report.
Tonight, in a key part of Florida, the signs say it all. President Trump is back in the battleground state he's visited more than any other, and a must win. The voters who could decide it live here, inside Central Florida's sprawling retirement community, the Villages. This year, Republicans are fired up. Democrats are too. Residents here are well aware that senior citizens make up 82% of COVID-19 deaths in the state. David Grimes, a one-time Republican prosecutor, is voting for Biden. He says he has little trust in the White House.
They say they value life, but they don't value elder life.
But Susan Morrell, a Trump supporter, says COVID-19 was not a concern of hers.
To me, it's a flu. I'm almost 70 years old. And am I worried about it? No, I'm not.
The candidates' battle for votes has been playing out in real time in Florida this week.
How many of you have been unable to hug your grandkids in the last 7 months?
The president, who took the demographic in 2016, has been trying to shore up support.
Biden's agenda would be a catastrophe for Florida seniors.
A recent poll of likely voters in Florida shows those 65 and older back Biden, 55% to 40% over Trump. Chris Stanley, the head of the Villages Democratic Club, says she's heard from Republicans making the switch.
I have it at anywhere between
5.5 and 6.2% that we've peeled off support from the villages. And so that's significant.
It doesn't sound like a lot, but that can make a huge difference in Florida.
That could make a difference in Florida. That could win or lose this race.
Victor Akendo joins us now from the villages in Florida. And Victor, seniors traditionally vote in high numbers, but of course the pandemic is complicating things this year. How are people there planning on casting their ballots, and how do they think that election night will go?
Lindsay, every single resident that we spoke with today told us that they've already voted by mail. They also expect President Trump to win the villages, but the big question is by how big or by how small of a margin. Lindsay?
And many of us remember that video that President Trump retweeted with residents there clashing over the summer in their golf carts. Did you feel any of that tension there as you were talking to these seniors who live side by side in this typically close-knit community?
There is definitely some tension here, Lindsay. While we were speaking with the head of the Democratic Club, our interview was interrupted once or twice by some Trump supporters. And she also shared a story with us about a Biden supporter who woke up one morning to find out that someone had taken weed killer to their front lawn to write the name Trump all over it.
Oh,
Lindsay?
Wow. Okay. Victor Akendo, our thanks to you. And when we return, you may have heard about sea level rise posing a threat to cities like Miami. Ginger Z explains it's not just for the reasons you might think. Stay with us.
With so much at stake, so much on the line, more Americans turn here than any place else. ABC News World News Tonight with David Muir.
We have made it through another week together.
America's most watched program across all of television.
Hello?
This is Montana Highway Patrol. You're looking for a couple of missing teenagers.
That's right. When the night last seen in a red Focus. Has
come. The steering wheel is getting stiff.
Lock the door.
We're fine.
No, I won't be afraid. Be afraid. Be afraid.
Got ourselves a predicament.
When the night has come.
Yes, mornings may look different these days, but where you start your day,
where you spend your mornings, where you get connected to everything that's happening.
And face it, there's a whole lot happening in our world these days.
Where you get all the breaking new information of the day to help you navigate through these times.
That's why we're here.
Good morning, sunshine.
And making sure you start your day off with a smile and some sunshine.
Good morning, America.
Good morning, America.
Good morning, America. Oh, how I love saying that. Wake me
up. Cross my office off the list.
What if we pick for each other?
Please stop. Yes!
Finally tonight, a look at the impact rising seas are having in South Florida. And it's not just flooding. A beautiful bay, an entire ecosystem is at risk. So in this week's It's Not Too Late, our Ginger Z takes a look at the imminent threat to Miami's fragile water infrastructure.
Hi, I'm Ginger Z, and it's not too late. Today, I want to talk about sea level rise in Miami. I know, you're probably saying to yourself, duh. We know that the sea is rising in Miami. We've seen the video of water overtaking the buildings. We know that sea level has risen 5 inches since 1993. And we've also seen the $400 million pump system that was recently installed just to keep their feet dry. But this story is about the less obvious and even more imminent threat, the quality of the water, specifically Biscayne Bay.
To have this many, this volume of fish looking for oxygen, they're almost air gulping over there.
Now, Biscayne Bay is the turquoise paradise that laps at the coast of Southeast Florida, right about here. It also kisses that strip of land, the barrier island, we call Miami Beach.
Biscayne Bay generates billions of dollars annually for our regional economy. It's one of the jewels of the state of Florida. It has parts of it that are so protected and special that you're not even allowed to kayak through it without a permit.
Biscayne Bay is protected in so many ways, but currently it's dying. thanks in part to sea level rise. Kevin Linsky heads up Miami-Dade County's water and sewer system, and he says that their department has to plan for a worst-case scenario.
If you look from now until 2040, so 20-year horizon, we're planning on, worst case, about 11 inches of sea level rise, which if you live in South Florida, that's a very frightening thing. In your coastal community, it's worse still.
And on top of that, the water's being polluted by runoff from fertilizer, litter, and waste from, get this, septic tanks. Yes, septic tanks. It's something that most of us think are reserved for farms and rural homes, but they still have them in the city of Miami.
We have over 100,000 septic tanks in Miami-Dade County still to this day, and we need to transition those septic tanks and connect them to our sewer system, which is also aging ASAP, because those septics are just spewing wastewater into our groundwater. Whatever goes into our groundwater goes into our bay, and that's pretty disgusting.
In a typical septic setup, the waste from your house enters the tank. Then the solid part of the waste settles to the bottom. The water that is above that goes to the drain field to be clarified. Now, when sea level rises, the drain field mixes with the groundwater, and the septic can fail. Yeah, that means your waste from your toilet could go directly into the groundwater, and in this case, into Biscayne Bay. There are also big problems coming from the inland parts of Florida.
If you went into all the area where humans live today in South Florida, you would have been in muck. Today they call it the Everglades, a beautiful place. We all love it. We all protect it. Back then it was a swamp, and they sought to drain the swamp.
This is a project of mammoth proportions.
So they came in and started building canal systems, and they drained all the water out of the Everglades in a giant zone where humans could live and build agriculture.
And now, those canals pick up trash, nitrogen, and phosphorus from fertilizer and toxins that we're putting on our agriculture and on our lawns. And then they dump it all right into the bay. All those chemicals were also met with historic heat this summer, drowning out the oxygen in the bay. And without oxygen, this happens. Thousands of fish died.
Now, what happened with the fish kill, that was an unprecedented, once-in-a-lifetime phenomenon that, regrettably, because of climate change and our rising water temperatures, is likely to happen again. So what you had the day of the fish kill was water temperatures that were 6 degrees higher than normal. You had no circulation in the bay. You had no wind. And you had the, you know, incredible amount of nutrients that were seeping into the bay due to marine debris and due to sewage spills and septic leaks. And that created this lack of oxygen in different various pockets of the northern basin of the bay.
Summer is always hot in Florida, but this past summer was next level. 7 of the top 10 warmest weeks in Miami's history happened in 2020. It wasn't just breaking records in the hot afternoons either, but instead it was also the overnights. That's when it's supposed to get cooler. Temperatures in the 80s. Can you imagine in the overnight? Well, Miami had 6 consecutive nights of record warm lows. 3 of them were all-time records. Louis Aguirre from our Miami affiliate WPLG did an entire special called Saving Biscayne Bay.
We noticed that the floor of the bay was littered with dead fish.
There is urgency happening now that has never happened before, but there's a vigilance, there's an awareness actually happening now in Miami-Dade County where people are going to start to hold our leaders accountable.
Miami Waterkeeper, an advocacy group, says that Miami needs big changes, not just in sewage infrastructure, but they also have to regulate the use of fertilizer and other chemicals.
Sea level rise is having a negative effect in making all of these pollution sources worse. So we urgently need to be doing these investments and taking these opportunities we have to retrofit how our city is built and how it functions to be ready for sea level rise. I think that we have to, and I think it's imperative not just for Biscayne Bay, but to our ability to continue to live here, to fix these problems and to tackle them head on.
Now I do have some good news. Biscayne Bay can recover. It would be a slow process, but if you look at their neighbors in Tampa Bay, they too were at a tipping point about 4 decades ago. Their seagrass was killed off by pollution and algae blooms, but it took 30 years, and now they've brought back their bay. Today, seagrass in Tampa Bay covers the same area it did in the 1950s, and that's nearly twice the size of Manhattan. So, if Miami starts now, I promise it's not too late.
Minimally, those dead fish in the water perhaps will serve as a wake-up call for many. Our thanks to Ginger Z for that. Before we go tonight, our image of the day. Pro-democracy protesters in Thailand flashing a three-fingered salute during a protest as they occupy a main road in the heart of Bangkok. This all stems from a student-led protest, which has even targeted the king, which is unheard of until recently. Certainly lots of firsts lately. That is our show for tonight. Be sure to stay tuned to ABC News Live for more context and analysis of the day's top stories. I'm Lindsay Davis. Thanks so much for streaming with us. The special edition 2020 Town Hall with Joe Biden is coming up next.
With so much at stake, so much on the line, more Americans turn here than any place else. ABC News World News Tonight with David Muir.
We have made it through another week together.
America's most watched program across all of television. It's being called the most consequential election of a lifetime, the most important vote. And with so much on the line, it demands the most straightforward newsmaking, real answers, the most informed voices from all sides. The countdown is on to the vote. What will our future look like? ABC's This Week with George. It all plays out right here every Sunday.
The most consequential week yet of this hyper-political year.
Right as you get closer to casting your vote every Sunday on ABC.
Good evening from the National Constitution Center in Philadelphia. Our town hall with Joe Biden starts right now.
This is an ABC News 2020 event special.
Let's stand up and vote and take back this country now.
With an ongoing pandemic, a Supreme Court vacancy, economic uncertainty, and racial injustice dominating this election, final voting is just 19 days away. Tonight, voters in a key battleground state put their questions directly to former Vice President Joe Biden. Can he seize the moment and secure their vote? Live from the National Constitution Center in Philadelphia, this special edition of 2020, The Vice President and the People. Now reporting, Chief Anchor George Stephanopoulos.
And welcome to our town hall with Joe Biden. Mr. Vice President, welcome to you.
Good to be with you.
We're here with a group of Pennsylvania voters. You can see they're all appropriately socially distanced tonight. And they're a group of, some are voting for you, some have said they're voting for President Trump, some are still undecided. And we're going to try to take questions from as many of them as we can tonight. And we're going to start with Nicholas Fedden. He's from Jenkintown, Pennsylvania. That's close to here in Philadelphia. You're a Democrat.
I am a Democrat. Thank you, George. Mr. Vice President, every day my wife and I are in disbelief at the lack of coordinated federal action on COVID-19. We know that your administration would follow the science. My question for you, it's two parts. First, looking backwards to when this country first became aware of COVID-19, what would following the science have meant in terms of actual policy? And then, looking forward, what would your administration do in terms of following the science with real concrete policies that haven't been done by the current administration?
Well, first of all, going back, the fact is that the president was informed how dangerous this virus was. And all the way back in the beginning of February, I argued that we should be keeping people in China. And we had set up in our administration a pandemic office within the White House. There were 44 people on the ground. I suggested we should be seeking, and I didn't hold public office. I was a former vice president. I suggested we, in fact, ask to have access to the source of the problem. And to the best of our knowledge, Trump never pushed that. All those 44 people came home, never got replaced. In addition to that, I pointed out that I thought in February, I did a piece for USA Today saying this is a serious problem. Trump denied it. He said it wasn't. We later learned that he knew full well how serious it was when he did an interview with Bob Woodward. And at the time, he said he didn't tell anybody because he was afraid Americans would panic. Americans don't panic. He panicked. He didn't say a word to anybody. Then I wrote a piece in March about what I thought we should be doing to take hold of this, using there's an act that passed a long time ago that allows the president to go into a business and say, stop making this and start making that. And it took a long time for him to even institute that, to get ventilators and so on. And so the point was, he missed enormous opportunities and kept saying things that weren't true. It's going to go away by Easter. Don't worry about it. It's going to all, when the summer comes, it's all going to go away like a miracle. He's still saying those things.
Mr. Before you go to the future, can I follow up on looking backward just a little bit? You did have an op-ed in January where you warned to the seriousness of the pandemic, but there's no record of you calling for social distancing, limited social gathering, mandatory masks.
Not back then.
In January, February.
No, January, February. No, that's correct. There wasn't. That came at the end of March, and then I laid out a detailed plan relative to school openings in June and July, and I talked about, by that time, the science was becoming clearer and clearer of how this was spreading so rapidly. But the president kept denying that. If you notice, from March on, I stopped doing big meetings. I started wearing masks. So it was at a time when the science was saying, and his key people, Dr. Fauci, were saying, you should be taking these precautions. So what we should be doing now, there should be a national standard instead of leaving this up. Remember what the president said to the governors. Well, they're on their own. That's not my responsibility. The governors can do what they need to do. Not my responsibility. It is the presidential responsibility to lead. And he didn't do that. He didn't talk about what needed to be done because he kept worrying, in my view, about the stock market. He worried if he talked about how bad this could be unless we took these precautionary actions, then, in fact, the market would go down. And his barometer of success to the economy is the market. Thirdly, what we didn't do is the president had an opportunity to open and allow schools and businesses to stay open if they got the kind of help they needed. So the Congress passed a couple $1 trillion worth of help, and what happened was most of that money, significant portion of that money, went to the very wealthiest corporations in the country, didn't get to the mom and pop stores. So you had one in six minority businesses closing, many of them permanently, people being laid off. And then what happened was when the first tranche of the first round of money for unemployment, enhanced unemployment, went by. He didn't do anything. He didn't do anything. And to the best of my knowledge, and I mean this sincerely, I can't think, I've been around for a lot of presidents, and you know a lot of presidents in a crisis, I don't ever remember one never calling the House and Senate, Republicans and Democrats together.
Let's look forward a little bit. You said that you would lock down the economy only if the scientists said it was necessary.
Well, by the way, that wasn't the context here. They said, would I lock down the economy if science said so? I said I'd follow science. But I don't think there's a need to lock down.
But I want to press you on that point.
Sure.
You've been in the Oval Office for 8 years with President Obama. He would always say that only the hard to solve problems get to his desk. What is most likely to happen is the scientists will disagree. The scientists will disagree with the economists. So the question is, how are you going to decide this? Who are you going to listen to? And how can you contain the pandemic without crushing the economy?
Well, you can contain the pandemic by being rational and not crush the economy. For example, I laid out a plan how you can open businesses. You can open businesses and schools if, in fact, you provide them the guidance that they need as well as the money to be able to do it. What's happening now is we know, for example, if you can open a business and you could have a sign on the door saying safe to come in, that's why people aren't going anyway, even when they're open, and say because you have social distancing, you have plastic barriers when you go to the cashier, you have separators between the booths, you don't have large crowds, you reduce the size, the number of people you can have in the restaurant, you make sure there's testing. That's a really critical piece that he didn't do, testing and tracing, and you make sure that people are equipped, going to schools. You know, the government initially said they're going to provide masks for every student and every teacher. Then they said, no, FEMA said that the president or whomever said, no, that's not a national emergency. not a national emergency. We need more teachers in our schools to be able to open smaller pods. We need ventilation systems changed. Well, there's a lot of things we know now. And I laid them out in some detail. Now, again, when I say I laid them out, I'm not an office holder. I'm running for office. It's not like I'm still vice president or I was a United States senator pushing this. So I don't want to say I. But we did lay out exactly what needed to be done. And take a look. We make up 4% of the world's population. We have 20% of the world's deaths. We're in a situation where we have 210,000+ people dead. And what's he doing? Nothing. He's still not wearing masks and so on.
We're getting some other questions on COVID. Sure. The next one comes from Kelly Lee. She's from Philadelphia.
Thank you.
Republican. Voted for Donald Trump in 2016. Undecided now.
Hey, Kelly, how are you?
Hi, Mr. Biden. My question is about the coronavirus vaccine.
Yes.
Or potential. Senator Harris stated that she absolutely would not take a vaccine from President Trump. And of course, we all know it's not President Trump that would create this vaccine. It would be doctors and scientists that presumably we all trust. So my question for you is, if a vaccine were approved by between now and the end of the year, would you take it? And if you were to become president, would you mandate that everyone has to take it?
Two things. Number one, President Trump talks about things that just aren't accurate about everything from vaccines. We're going to have one right away. It's going to happen and so on. The point is that if the body of scientists say that this is what is ready to be done and it's been tested, they've gone through the three phases, yes, I would take it. I'd encourage people to take it. But President Trump says things like, you know, everything from as crazy stuff he's walking away from now, inject bleach in your arm and that's going to work. I'm not being facetious, though. I mean, he's actually said these things. And now Regeneron is the answer. That's going to cure everything. There's 500,000 doses. We got a couple, you know, we have more than a few million people. Most of the companies who are developing these vaccines they're making real progress. I meet with four leading scientists at least twice a week in the beginning, four times a week, giving us the detail on what kind of progress is being made. And right now, they do the right thing. When they run into a serious problem, they halt the test. They don't continue until they figure out what the problem was. They're not there yet. And the most scientists say that's not likely to have a vaccine that would be available until the beginning of next year, into the spring of next year. And in the meantime, what I worry about is the same thing with Regeneron, which is a useful tool. But what's happening is there is no plan to figure out how to distribute it. How many, you know, we have 500,000, you know, vials of it. Well, we don't have all the testing equipment. We don't have all the ability to get it to the people who need it. And what we should be doing now, and allegedly it's happening, but I've not seen it yet, nor the docs that I've talked to seen it, there should be a plan when we have the vaccine, how do we distribute it?
And once we get it, if it's safe, if it's effective, will you mandate its use?
The answer is depending on how clear there's vaccines, they say, have a very positive impact and they're going to affect positively 85% of the American public. Or there's others say this vaccine is really the key. This is the golden key. It depends on the state of the nature of the vaccine, when it comes out, and how it's being distributed. That would depend on. But I would think that we should be talking about, depending on the continuation of the spread of the virus, we should be thinking about making it mandatory.
How could you enforce that?
Well, you couldn't. That's the problem. Just like you can't enforce measles. You can't come to school unless you have a measles shot. You know, you can't. But you can't say everyone has to do this. But you would, just like you can't mandate a mask. But you can say, you can go to every governor and get them all in a room, all 50 of them as president, and say, ask people to wear the mask. Everybody knows.
And if they don't, fine.
And they don't, no, not fine. Then I go to every governor, I go to every mayor, I go to every councilman, I go to every local official, say, mandate the mask. Man, say, this is what you have to do when you're out. Make sure you encourage it being done. Look, George, you and I know, and I think you do too as well, the words of a president matter.
Absolutely.
No matter whether they're good, bad, or indifferent, they matter. And when a president doesn't wear a mask or makes fun of folks like me when I was wearing a mask for a long time, then, you know, people say, well, it mustn't be that important. But when a president says, I think this is very important, for example, I walked in here with this mask, but I have one of the M95 masks underneath it. I left it in my dressing room, the room I was in before I got here. And so I think it matters what we say. And we're now learning that children are getting the virus, not with as serious consequences, but there's been no studies done yet on vaccines for children. So there's a long way to go, but we can make progress in the meantime and save lives. And last point I'll make, if you listen to the head of the CDC, he stood up and he said, you know, while we're waiting for a vaccine, and he held up a mask, you wear this mask, you'll save more lives between now and the end of the year than if we had a vaccine. It's estimated by every major study done from the University of Washington to Columbia that if, in fact, we wore masks, we could save between now and the end of the year 100,000 lives.
And avoid lockdowns?
And avoid lockdown, yes. You don't have to lock down if you're wearing the mask.
Let's get a question on the economy. Anthony Argyrakis.
Thank you. I hope I answered your question.
From Canonsburg, Pennsylvania. It's a suburb of Pittsburgh. Republican.
I know
it. For President Trump.
Thank you, George. Thank you, Mr. Vice President. You stated that anyone making less than $400,000 will not see one single penny of their taxes raised.
That's right.
But also state that you are going to eliminate the Trump tax cuts. The Trump tax cuts reduces taxes for the majority of workers. I would argue not enough. What is your plan for either extending the tax cuts for the middle class or creating a new plan that further reduces those taxes?
I carry this card with me. When I said the Trump tax cuts, about $1.3 trillion of the $2 trillion in his tax cuts went to the top 0.1%. That's what I'm talking about eliminating, not all the tax cuts that are out there. And by the way, if you just take a look, we reduced the corporate tax rate from 35%, and Democrats and Republicans who were in office thought it should come down to 28%. He reduced it to 21%. You have 91 out of every of the Fortune 500 companies not paying a single solitary penny. If you raise the corporate tax just back to 28%, which is a fair tax, you'd raise $1,300 billion by that one act. If you made sure the people making over 400 grand paid what they did in the Bush administration, 39.6%, you would raise another, as goes up to, let me get you the exact number here, about another $92 billion. So you can raise a lot of money to be able to invest in things that can make your life easier. Make you change your standard of living by making sure you have affordable health care, by making sure you're in a situation where you're able to send your kid to school, and if you have a student debt, you can deal with it, making sure that your home, you can pay your mortgage. You got 20 million people right now.
Mr. President, let me press you on that, though.
Sure.
You're going to raise the corporate tax, you're going to raise taxes on the wealthy. Is it wise to do even that when the economy is as weak as it is right now? Another 900,000 people.
That's a great question. Moody's did an analysis of my detailed analysis of my tax plan and my economic plan. They said, I will in 4 years, Moody's, Wall Street, said I will create 18.6 million new jobs, good paying jobs, number one. Number two, and I'll increase, the GDP will grow by $1 trillion more than it would under Trump and 7 million more jobs than under Trump. And the reason is when you allow people to get back in the game and have a job, everything moves. Everything moves. Right now, you got the opposite. You had last year, during this pandemic, you had the wealthiest billionaires in the world, in the nation. They made another $700 billion. $700 billion. He talks about a V-shaped recovery. It's a K-shaped recovery. If you're on the top, you're going to do very well. And the other thing and if you're at the bottom, or you're in the middle or the bottom, your income is coming down. You're not getting a raise. I don't know what you do. You may get a raise. Hope you're a billionaire. But all kidding aside, but it's about growing the economy. And George, the way out, the reason why I'm so optimistic about economic recovery, more than I've ever been, is we have these four crises happening all at once, and one helps the other. For example, we're going to invest a great deal of that money into infrastructure. And to a green infrastructure. We're going to put 500,000 charging stations on new highways we're building and old highways we're building. We're going to own the electric market. You know as well as I do from your days, you know, in the old days, where the president spends about $600 billion a year on government contracts. Everything from making sure they have aircraft carriers to automobile fleets for the in the United States. If you make and we can, and it's not violation of any international trade agreement, made in America. If you actually insist that whatever that product is made in America, including the material that goes into the product, it's estimated we're going to create somewhere between another 4 and 6 million jobs just by doing that. But what's happening now? Under his trade policy, a lot of this is going overseas. You get a benefit from going overseas. If you have much of it being made overseas. So if you send it overseas, you get a 10% tax increase on your on the product. If you make it in America and you bring it back, you get a 10% growth. If you bring back a company and you're going to open up an old facility, you get a 10% tax credit for all you invested. That actually works, George.
So there's not going to be any delay on the tax increases?
No, well, I got to get the votes. That's why, you know, the one thing that I have this strange notion. We are a democracy. Some of my Republican friends and some of my Democratic friends even occasionally say, well, if you can't get the votes by executive order, you're going to do something. Things you can't do by executive order unless you're a dictator. We're a democracy. We need consensus.
Got to take a quick break. We'll be right back.
I hope I answered your question.
We the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America. This special edition of 2020 will return in a moment.
Welcome to Disney Plus. Are you ready? Drop in and explore the action, the adventure, and the originals. There's no limit to what you'll find. These are your worlds. So come on, dive deeper into the universes you love. Wherever and whenever you want them, you'll find them all here on Disney Plus.
Yes, mornings may look different these days, but where you start your day,
where you spend your mornings, where you get connected to everything that's happening.
And face it, there's a whole lot happening in our world these days.
Where you get all the breaking new information of the day to help you navigate through these times.
That's why we're here.
Good morning, sunshine.
And making sure you start your day off with a smile and some sunshine.
Good morning, America.
Good morning, America.
Good morning, America. Oh, how I love saying that. Wake me
up. I know what happened, and I'm not guilty.
Why the fascination with criminal trials? Figure out what's really out there.
She revealed she had murdered his family.
I know in my heart they did this.
It's the time of suspicion.
The ending's really tough.
You don't know whether truth is going to be difficult to find unless you try to find it.
It's being called the most consequential election of a lifetime, the most important vote, and with so much on the line, it demands the most straightforward, news-making, real answers, the most informed voices from all sides. The countdown is on to the vote. What will our future look like? ABC's This Week with George. It all plays out right here every Sunday.
The most consequential week yet of this hyper-political year.
Right as you get closer to casting your vote, every Sunday on ABC.
Who was John Lennon?
Magical.
Brilliant.
Daring.
Rebel.
A working class kid from Liverpool.
John was my favorite Beatle.
If he hadn't dreamed so beautifully, it wouldn't hurt so much.
Now, Friday night, new interviews with those who were right there with John Lennon and his last interview, all on that day.
While there's life, there's hope.
The 2020 event.
Yoko said, what I tell you now is top secret. You can't ever tell anyone.
John Lennon, his life, his legacy, his last days. Friday night on ABC.
What's the most innovative daily news podcast out there to listen to every day? Well, the Edward R. Murrow Awards say it's Start Here, the daily news podcast from ABC News. Even the New York Times calls us a top news podcast worth listening to. So if you like getting behind the biggest news stories of the day, inside all the details, the backstory, and what will happen next, then listen to Start Here, the daily news podcast from ABC News. It's like no other news podcast out there. Even the critics agree. Listen free on Apple Podcasts.
Now could be a good time to have another baby.
Are you crazy?
I'm in love with you.
Now that I said it out loud, it does sound weird.
Please stop. When I
see you were so fine, I had to remind myself to breathe. I feel something
when I see you. Let's do this.
How's your quarantine going?
The right of citizens of the United States to vote shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or by any state on account of race, color, or previous condition of servitude. From the Constitution Center in Philadelphia, here again, George Stephanopoulos.
And welcome back to our town hall with Joe Biden. We're going to get a question now from Cedric Humphrey. He's a student from Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, progressive Democrat.
Don't jump, Cedric. You look like you're way up there.
I'll be okay. Thank you, George. And good evening, former Vice President Biden. Many people believe that the true swing demographic in this election will be black voters under the age of 30. Not because they'll be voting for Trump, but because they won't vote at all. I myself have had this exact same conflict. So my question for you then is, besides you ain't black, what do you have to say to young black voters who see voting for you as further participation in a system that continually fails to protect them?
Well, I say, first of all, as my buddy John Lewis said, it's a sacred opportunity and right to vote. You can make a difference. If young black women and men vote, you can determine the outcome of this election. Not a joke. You can do that. Now, the next question is, am I worthy of your vote? Can I earn your vote? And the answer is, there's two things I think that I care, and I've demonstrated I care about my whole career. One is, in addition to dealing with a criminal justice system to make it fair and make it more decent, we have to be able to put black Americans in a position to be able to gain wealth, generate wealth. And so you look at what that entails. It entails everything from early education. That's why I'm supporting making sure that we entitle one schools, as you know, schools with the least tax base to be able to support their schools. I increased the funding for them from $15 to $45 billion. That allows every teacher in that school to make up to $60,000. And the problem now is they're leaving the schools. They're not there. We're short about 1.5 million teachers, 1.25 million teachers. Number two, every 3, 4, and 5-year-old will go to school, not daycare, school. And what all the great universities, including the one you've gone to, go to or went to, in fact, talks about in the last 8 years, what's happened. What happens when you let them go to school, they make up rapidly shortcoming they had in terms of their education prior to that. They have not heard as many words spoken, et cetera, et cetera. What happens is that the studies show that 58% will increase by 58% their chance of going all through 12 years of school and going through successfully. We'll also provide for the ability to bring in social workers and school psychologists. We have one school psychologist in America now for every 1,507 kids. It should be 1 to 500, not just in schools that are poor, but in all schools. Because we learned that, for example, drug abuse doesn't cause mental illness. Mental illness causes drug abuse, the failure to get hold of people and deal with their anxieties. In addition to that, I I provide for $70 billion for HBCUs for them to be able to have the wherewithal to do what other universities can do because they don't have the kind of foundational support they need. And so that would allow them, for example, like we did in our administration, the president allowed me to go down and we awarded a cybersecurity laboratory ability to compete for a cybersecurity laboratory. The federal government spends billions of dollars a year on universities because they're the best kept secret or where most of the major inventions come out of. And so that school now will be able to produce young black women and men who are going to go into a field of the future that's burgeoning, cybersecurity. And that's what's going to help a great deal. In addition to that, if you're a young man about to graduate or you graduated from school and you want to own your first home, it's awful hard to get the money, depending on the background, your economic background is, to get a down payment. So we're going to guarantee first-term home buyers a $15,000 down payment for first-term home buyers. In addition to that, what all the studies now show, and I've been arguing this for a long time, is young black entrepreneurs are just as successful as white entrepreneurs or anyone else given a shot. But you can't get the money. Where do you go to get the startup money? So what President Obama and I did, we had a program where we took $1.5 billion, and we invested it in all the SBAs around the country, in the state SBAs, small business associations, and that generated $30 billion came off the sideline, because if you have a guarantee of $200,000 for your new startup enterprise, young entrepreneur, you're going to be able to attract, if it's government money as a guarantee, you'll be able to attract another $100,000. It generated $30 billion. Well, I'm changing that program, and I'll get this done without much trouble, I believe, in the Congress, from $1.5 billion to $30 billion to $30 billion. That'll take $300 billion off the sideline and grow, because you know. And for example, if you, in fact, and I were the same age, and we split our differences, and we were the same age, and we went to the same builder to buy us each the same home, but my home was in a white neighborhood on one side of a highway, and yours is in a black neighborhood, same exact home. Your home will start off being valued 29% less than my home, yet your insurance for that home will be higher. You'll be taxed more for it. We've got to end this. That's what got me involved in politics in the first place, a thing called redlining. We can change so much that we can do so much to change the circumstances to give people a real opportunity.
Cedric, did you hear what you needed to hear?
I think so.
Okay. Well, there's a lot more if you're going to hang around afterwards, I'll tell you more.
Okay.
Let's get it.
No, but I really mean it. It is the key. Look, this is the way every other, like my dad, he lost his job up in Scranton. And it took him 3 years to be able to move down to Delaware, to Claymont, Delaware, a little steel town, and sent us home to our grandpa to live with him. We finally got back. We lived in apartments, became 6 and 8 housing much later. It was just normal apartments. But it took him 5 years to be able to buy a home. Well, we bought a 3-bedroom home with 4 kids and a grandpa living with us, but it accumulated wealth. You built up wealth. That's how middle-class folks make it. They build up wealth. Then he was able to borrow a little against that to be able to help us get to school, those kinds of things. It's about accumulating wealth. And it's you're behind an eight ball. The vast majority of people of color are behind an eight ball. And it's the same way what's going on now with all this money that's been voted. What's happened? You go to the bank, if you're a black businessman, and the president fired the only inspector general to oversee all this help coming from the Congress. And what happens? You go in and they say, do you have an account here? No. Do you have a credit card with this? No. Have you borrowed from us before? No. We bail these suckers out. They're not liable for any of the money. But they still won't lend it to you. We got to change that. It's about accumulating wealth.
Want to get another question in here from Angelica Politaros? No, not at all. Garnet Valley, Pennsylvania.
Hi.
Republican who voted for President Trump last time.
Thank you. Thank you, George. Thank you, Vice President Biden. Nice to meet you. What's your view on the crime bill that you wrote in 1994, which showed prejudice against minorities? Where do you stand today on that?
Well, first of all, things have changed drastically. That crime bill went and voted. The Black Caucus voted for it. Every Black mayor supported it across the board. And it didn't. The crime bill itself did not have mandatory sentences except for two things. What it had three strikes and you're out, which I voted against in the crime bill. But it had a lot of other things in it that turned out to be both bad and good. I wrote the Violence Against Women Act. That was part of it. The assault weapons ban and other things that were good. What I was against was giving states more money for prison systems that they could build, state prison systems. And you have 93 out of every 100 people in jail now is in a state prison, not in a federal prison, because they built more prisons. I also wrote into that bill a thing called drug courts. I don't believe anybody should be going to jail for drug use. They should be going into mandatory rehabilitation. We should be building rehab centers to have these people housed. We should wipe out, we should decriminalize marijuana, wipe out the record so you can actually say in honesty, you ever been arrested for anything, you can say no, because we're going to pass a law saying there is no background that you have to reveal relative to the use of marijuana. And so there's a lot of things, but in addition to that, we got to change the system. I joined with a group of people in the House to provide for changing the system from punishment to rehabilitation, along with a guy named Arlen Specter, who you may remember. I wrote the Second Chance Act.
But in the meantime, an awful lot of people were jailed for minor drug crimes after the
exactly
crime.
Right.
Was it a mistake to support it?
Yes, it was. But here's where the mistake came. The mistake came in terms of what the states did locally. What we did federally, we said it was, and you remember, George, it was all about the same time for the same crime. What I had done as chairman of the Judiciary Committee, I did, took the 10 Circuit Courts of Appeals, took some really brilliant lawyers working for me in Judiciary. We did a study. And we determined what happens if, for the first, second, third offense, for any crime in the criminal justice system, at the federal level, if you're a Black man, it's the first time you committed robbery. How long would you go to jail on average? If you're a white man, how long? Black man would go to jail on average 13 years. White man, 2 years. I go down the list of every single crime. So we set up a sentencing commission. We didn't set the time. Every single solitary maximum was reduced in there. But what happened was it became the same time for the same crime. So it said you have to serve between 1 and 3 years. It ended up becoming much lower. Black folks went to jail a lot less than they would have before, but it was a mistake.
Let me ask another follow-up on the crime bill. It also funded 100,000 police back in 1994. You've often said that more cops clearly mean less crime. Do you still believe that?
Yes, if in fact they're involved in community policing, not jump squads. For example, when we had community policing from the mid-90s on till Bush got elected, what happened? Violent crime actually went down precipitously. Remember the significant rise in violent crime that was occurring in the late 80s into the 90s. It went down, and fewer African Americans were arrested because you had the requirement. The cops didn't like it. They didn't like the community policing because you had to have two people in a vehicle. They had to get out of their cars. They had to introduce themselves to who owned the local liquor store, who owned the local grocery store, who was the woman on the corner. And what they would do, George, they'd actually go and give people their phone numbers. A cop would give the phone number. So if Nellie Smith was on the second floor where drug deals took place and things happened below her, her apartment, she could call and say, it's Millie, and there's something going on here. And they'd never reveal it was her, because they know if she knew that, in fact, they'd report, they'd never report the crime. She'd never report. So it actually started to come down. What happened? They eliminated the funding for community policing. Community policing doesn't mean more people coming in and up-armored Humvees and swarming like that. When they did, it turned out that by the time we got to the late 90s, the crime had come down so much, and the mayors and everybody asked the question, where do you want me to spend the money? They say, well, only 1% thought violent crime was a problem. It was as high as 22%.
Right now, we have a systemic problem. How do you get the kind of policing, prevent the kind of policing?
You have to change the way in which they police. One of the things I'm going to do, George, is what is set up a national study group made up of cops, social workers, as well as made up of the Black community and the brown community to sit down in the White House and over the next year come up with significant reforms that need to take place within communities. You have to bring them together. One of the things I've observed is, you know, the neighborhood I grew up in Claymont, either became a cop, a firefighter, or a priest. I wasn't qualified much to do any one of them. But here's the deal, all kidding aside, most cops don't like bad cops.
Correct.
They don't like it.
Correct.
And so what happens is they get intimidated into not reporting. So one of the things we do is there has to be transparency available. We have to be able to go in at the federal level, be able to go in and check out whether or not there's systematic problems within police departments. If, in fact, a cop needs to be tried, it's not the prosecutor in the community, in the district where they are. You got to go outside the community to get another prosecutor to come in and handle the crime. There's a lot of things we've learned, and it takes time, but we can do this. You can ban chokeholds, beyond that, you have to teach people how to de-escalate circumstances. De-escalate. So instead of anybody coming at you and the first thing you do is shoot to kill, you shoot them in the leg. There's ways you have to do more background checks in terms of whether or not the person coming in passes certain psychological tests. And the last thing I'll say, and I'm sorry, but it's really, I think, really, really important, is you have to be in a position where you are able to identify the things that have to change. And one of the things that has to change is so many cops get called into circumstances where somebody is mentally off, like what happened not long ago with that guy with the knife. That's why we have to provide within police departments psychologists and social workers to go out with the cops on those calls, some of those 911 calls, to de-escalate the circumstance, to deal with talking them down. But we can't. Cops are kind of like school teachers now. You know, a school teacher has to know everything from how to handle hunger in a household, as well as how to teach you how to read. Well, cops don't have that breath. And there's a lot of things we can do. We shouldn't be defunding cops. We should be mandating the things that we should be doing within police departments and make sure there's total transparency.
Got to take another quick break. We'll be right back.
I don't know if I answered your question, but...
ABC News, straightforward. Tomorrow, get ready for an all-time high with all-time low. With an amazing performance for you. Tomorrow on Good Morning America's Concert Series, sponsored by CarMax.
I know what happened, and I'm not guilty.
Why the fascination with criminal trials? Figure out what's really out there.
She revealed she had murdered his family.
I know in my heart they did this.
It's the time of suspicion.
The ending's really tough.
You don't know whether truth is going to be difficult to find unless you try to find it.
On your carts. Get set.
Get ready.
The team with the highest card total could be leaving with $100,000.
To shop.
Bam, bam, bam.
Till you drop.
Oh, mommy down.
Leslie Jones hosts Supermarket Sweep. Premieres Sunday, October 18th on ABC.
This is what being live is all about. This is ABC News Live, the 24/7 streaming news source, ABC News. Breaking news, live events as they happen, streaming live, nonstop, straight to you. Original, on the edge, breakthrough storytelling from ABC News, National Geographic, ESPN, all designed differently for you to stream straight to any screen whenever you want, free. And imagine the most celebrated, epic live events and moments all playing out right before your eyes.
See those flames behind me?
And go deeper inside the groundbreaking exclusives from the campaign trail only ABC News gets. Watch ABC News Live right now and anytime. Streaming on Roku, Hulu, Facebook, and ABCNews.com.
ABC News Live.
Streaming everywhere right to you.
ABC News Live.
The waters of the Outer Banks are unforgiving. and full of riches for the fishermen who dare. The best of the northern fleet are heading south. But the locals know where the giants lie. And if you thought the waters were unforgiving, wait until the battle begins. Wicked Tuna Outer Banks. New episodes Sundays at 9 on National Geographic.
With so much at stake, so much on the line, more Americans turn here than any place else. ABC News, World News Tonight with David Muir.
We have made it through another week together.
America's most watched program across all of television.
Welcome to Disney Plus. Are you ready? Drop in and explore. The action. The adventure. And the originals. There's no limit to what you'll find. These are your worlds. So come on. Dive deeper into the universes you love. Wherever and whenever you want them. You'll find them all here on Disney Plus.
Now, with so much on the line, ABC News, America's number one news, is right there for you live on Hulu with stories of strength, stories of hope. Because now, when it matters most,
Hulu has live news.
Hulu has live news.
Hulu has live news. And that news is ABC News.
ABC News Live on Hulu.
ABC News Live on Hulu.
Watch the news you need.
Thanks so much for streaming with us.
Streaming to all Hulu subscribers right now. John Lennon, his life, his legacy, his last days.
While there's life, there's hope.
New interviews and his last interview. The new 2020 event, Friday night on ABC. He shall nominate, and by and with the advice and consent of the Senate, shall appoint judges of the Supreme Court and all other officers of the United States. From the Constitution Center in Philadelphia, here again, George Stephanopoulos.
And the Supreme Court is our next topic. The questioner, Nathan Osborne of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, Democrat.
Hi, I'm George, Mr. Vice President.
Hey, Nathan.
Our country's first Supreme Court gave its first rulings just two blocks from here, from 1791 to 1800, and it's become more polarized since then. Merrick Garland didn't get a hearing for all of 2016, and Amy Coney Barrett's being pushed through at the last minute, even though millions have already voted. So what do you think about ideas from people like Pete Buttigieg and others to put in place safeguards that will help ensure more long-term balance and stability? And what do you say to LGBTQ Americans and others who are very worried right now about erosions of their rights and our democracy as a whole?
Well, let me start the last point, work my way back. I think there's great reason to be concerned. I was on the road most of the time during these hearings, so I didn't hear many of them. I just got the recaps when I'd get in late at night from, I've been going around the country, Florida, and anyway. And, my reading online, what the judge said was she didn't answer very many questions at all. And I don't even think she has laid out much of a judicial philosophy in terms of the basis upon which she thinks are there unenumerated rights in the Constitution and the rest. So, number one. So I think there's great reason to be concerned for the LGBT community, something I fought very hard for a long time to make sure there's equality across the board. Number two, I think that also healthcare overall is very much in jeopardy as a consequence of the president's going to go directly after this election, directly to the Supreme Court within a month to try to get Obamacare wiped out after we've already, 10 million people have already lost their insurance from their employer and wants to take 20 million people out of the system as well, plus 100 million people with pre-existing conditions. So there's a lot at stake. I don't think it's appropriate. I think the Constitution implies. There's no provision in the Constitution. My problem is I made a mistake at teaching constitutional law for 21 years and the separation of powers. The Constitution implies that the way the people have a right to determine who's going to be on the court is how they vote for their senators and their presidents. We seek the advice and consent of the Senate and
the president's president for all 4 years, isn't he?
No, he is. But once an election begins, by implication, It is inconsistent with the constitutional principles, in my view. You get disagreement among scholars on this. But I believe it's inconsistent when millions of people already voted to put someone on the court. I think it should have been held until this election is over, see what the makeup of the Senate is going to be. If the president wins this election, he should be able
to. How about that question of expanding the court? Here's what you said exactly 1 year ago tonight at a Democratic debate. You said, I would not get into court packing. I would not pack the court. That's not what you're saying now. Is the nomination of Judge Barrett reason enough to rethink your position?
What is the nomination? What I wanted to do, George, you know, if I had answered the question directly, then all the focus would be on what's Biden going to do if he wins, instead of on is it appropriate what is going on now? And it should stay. This is the thing that the president loves to do. Always take our eye off the ball. What's at stake? One of the things Pete has suggested is, and there's a number of constitutional scholars have suggested as well, that there are at least four or five options that are available to determine whether or not you can change the way in which the court lifetime appointment takes place, consistent, arguably, with the Constitution. I have not been a fan of court packing because I think it just generates what will happen. Whoever wins, it just keeps moving in a way that is inconsistent with what is going to be manageable.
So you're still not a fan?
Well, I'm not a fan. I didn't say it depends on how this turns out, not how he wins, but how it's handled. But there's a number of things that are going to be coming up, and there's going to be a lot of discussion about other alternatives as well.
What does that mean, how it's handled? How will that determine
For example, if there's actually real live debate on the floor, if people are really going to be able to have a time to go through this, you know, I don't know anybody who's gone on the floor and that's been a controversial justice in terms of making fundamentally altering the makeup of the court that's gone through in a day kind of thing. I mean, it depends on how much they rush this. And you think about it, George. Here you got a lot of people not being able to pay their mortgage, not being able to put food on the table, not being able to keep their business open, not being able to do anything to deal with what's going on in terms of the economy as a consequence of COVID. And they have no time to deal with that, but they have time to rush this through.
Well, right now, it looks like they're going to have a vote around Halloween. So if they vote on it before the election, you are open to expanding the court?
I'm open to considering what happens from that point on.
You know, you said so many times during the campaign, all through the course of your career, it's important to level with
the American
people.
It is, but George, if I say, no matter what answer I gave you, if I say it, that's the headline tomorrow. It won't be about what's going on now, the improper way they're proceeding.
But don't voters have a right to know where you
stand?
They
do have a right to know where I stand, and they'll have a right to know where I stand before they vote.
So you'll come out with a clear position before Election Day?
Yes, depending on how they handle this. But look, what you should do is you got to make sure you vote. And vote for a senator who, in fact, reflects your general view on constitutional interpretation. And vote for a president who think is more in line with you. And if you oppose the position that I would not have appointed her, but if you oppose my position, vote for Trump. Vote for a Republican who shares that view. But that's your opportunity to get involved in lifetime appointments that have presidents come and go. Justices stay and stay and stay.
We have a question from a Republican, Andrew Lewis. I would guess a disaffected Republican. You cast a write-in vote for John Kasich in 2016. You're going to vote against President Trump this year.
And John's writing in for me, by the way.
I know that.
Mr. Vice President.
I'm sorry.
Mr. Vice President, my father, Drew Lewis, served as Secretary of Transportation under President Ronald Reagan in his first term.
Oh, yeah. I'll be darned.
And some of his closest allies and friends were Democrats, including House Speaker Tip O'Neill and Senator Ted Kennedy. Sadly, today, we have highly partisan and dysfunctional governance, and I believe President Trump is primarily responsible for creating this toxic environment. As president, how will you avoid the temptation to exact revenge and instead take the high road and attempt to restore bipartisanship, civility, and honor to our democracy?
As written by a fellow who won the Pulitzer Prize for a book he wrote about the presidency, he said, you know, I doubt whether Biden is really Irish. He doesn't hold a grudge. In politics, grudges don't work. They make no sense. I really mean it. I have never, and the second point I'd make is, everybody talks about, yeah, Joe, when you were a senator and a chairman of foreign relations or chairman of judiciary, you got a lot of things done. You're able to cross the aisle, but the days are changed. When you're vice president, you got a lot done, but it can't happen anymore. It can. We got to change the nature of the way we deal with one another. And it starts off by the way your father was and Tip was and others. You don't question another man or woman's motive. You can question their judgment, but not their motive. We badly need an infrastructure bill. Well, what happens? I stand up and I say, you know, we need an infrastructure bill, Senator, but I tell you what, you're in the pocket of the cement industry. But let's see what we can do. You can't get anywhere. Nothing happens. Nothing happens. I learned that lesson a long time ago. I've never, even when it's obvious on its face what the motive is, stick to the subject and listen to the other guy. Listen. What I will be doing as if I'm elected president, the first thing, and not a joke, and you can ask if they tell you your dad's old friends in the Republican side, I'm going to pick up the phone and call them and say, let's get together. We got to figure out how we're going to move forward here, because there's so many things we really do agree on. And with Trump out of the way, the vindictiveness of a president going after Republicans who don't do exactly what he says gets taken away. There's going to be, I promise you, between 4 and 8 Republican senators are willing to move on things where there's bipartisan consensus. Last example I'll give you. You know, after Trump had been elected, named the next president, wasn't sworn in yet. I've been working on a thing called a bill relating to cancer cures, okay? And it was called the Cancer Moonshot. And I worked with a number of Democrats and Republicans, and we had a bill that was about $9 billion that made significant increases in research and development on cancer alternatives, NIH, and particularly cancer-specific cancer initiatives. And we only had, at the time, I think it was 111 or 114, whatever it was, votes in the House. I don't hold the exact number. And we had fewer than 40 in the Senate. But after he was elected, I got those people together as vice president, and we sat down and we worked it out. And we ended up getting it passed 396 votes in the House and 94 votes in the Senate. And at the end of the day, because it had to do with the Biden cancer moonshot I've been working on, Mitch McConnell stood up, and I was presiding officer, and moved to name the bill after my deceased son, Beau, who had just died. So there are ways to bring this together.
But how about the question of political accountability? And is there some tension between that and bringing people together? You know, Robert Mueller laid out a lot of evidence of possible obstruction of justice by President Trump. What would a Biden Justice Department do with that evidence?
What the Biden Justice Department will do is let the Department of Justice be the Department of Justice. Let them make the judgments of who should be prosecuted. They are not my lawyers. They're not my personal lawyers.
So you're not going to rule it in or rule it out?
I'm not going to rule in or out. I'm going to hire really first-rate prosecutors and people who understand the law, like Democrat and Republican administrations have had, and let them make the judgments. But turning this into a vehicle for your, as if it's your own law firm, you don't own that Justice Department. You pick the best people you can, and you hope that what they're going to do is they're going to enforce the law as they see it. But can you remember any Republican president going out there or former Democratic president? Go find that guy and prosecute him. Ever hear that? Or, by the way, I'm being sued because a woman's accusing me of rape. Represent me. Represent me. Personally represent me in the state of New York on my not allowing my tax returns. What's that all about? What is that about?
Got to take another break. We'll be right back.
The executive power shall be vested in a president of the United States of America. He shall hold his office during the term of 4 years, and together with the vice president, chosen for the same term.
COVID-19 was a wake-up call. There are so many more pandemics that could be just around the corner. Viruses literally travel through human populations. What we've got to do is go to those places where the virus begins its journey.
Masks on?
Yep.
Masks on.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my God.
This is the exact way in which a new virus could start.
Virus Hunters, special event Sunday, November 1st at 9 on National Geographic.
With so much at stake, so much on the line, more Americans turn here than any place else. ABC News, World News Tonight with David Muir.
We have made it through another week together.
America's most watched program across all of television.
Yes, mornings may look different these days, but where you start your day,
where you spend your mornings, where you get connected to everything that's happening.
And face it, there's a whole lot happening in our world these days.
Where you get all the breaking new information of the day to help you navigate through these times.
That's why we're here.
Good morning, sunshine.
And making sure you start your day off with a smile and some sunshine.
Good morning, America.
Good morning, America.
Good morning, America. Oh, how I love saying that. Wake me
up. Hello?
This is Montana Highway Patrol. You're looking for a couple of missing teenagers.
That's right. When the night last seen in a red Focus.
The steering wheel is getting stiff.
Lock the door. We're fine. No, I won't
be afraid. Be afraid. Be afraid.
Got ourselves a predicament.
When the night has come.
Cross my office off the list.
What if we take for each other?
Please stop. Yes!
What's the most innovative daily news podcast out there to listen to every day? Well, the Edward R. Murrow Awards say it's Start Here, the daily news podcast from ABC News. Even the New York Times calls us a top news podcast worth listening to. So if you like getting behind the biggest news stories of the day, inside all the details, the backstory, and what will happen next, then listen to Start Here, the daily news podcast from ABC News. It's like no other news podcast out there. Even the critics agree. Listen free on Apple Podcasts.
Ready.
The team with the highest card total could be leaving with $100,000.
To shop.
Bam, bam, bam.
Till you drop.
Oh, mommy down.
Leslie Jones hosts Supermarket Sweep. Premieres Sunday, October 18th on ABC.
Right now, at this defining moment in America. With so much on the line.
We gonna be all right.
ABC News, Turning Point, the groundbreaking special Nightline series. Taking over, taking on. This moment for America. My America, your America, our America. This is Turning Point, the special Nightline series.
We gon' be all right.
Late night on ABC.
Now, when it matters most, the straightforward facts. ABC News is America's number one news. Number one in the morning, number one in the evening, and the number one show on all of television. Number one in late night versus the competition. Number one in politics versus the competition. The number one daytime talk show, and number one in streaming news. Most trusted, most watched. ABC News is America's number one news.
Admit it. These days, what you need to know
seems to change just about every day.
What is it that you really want to know, need to know?
To help you not just get through your day,
but to make the most of it. Feel smarter.
Feel better.
Feel happier.
Well, how about a third hour of Good Morning America in the afternoon?
GMA 3, what you need to know. Lunchtime at 1 Eastern, 12 Central and Pacific on ABC. It's all about you.
From the Constitution Center in Philadelphia, here again, George Stephanopoulos.
And welcome back to our town hall with former Vice President Joe Biden. We're going to look at the environment right now. We're going to get a question from Michelle Elise and from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, a businesswoman, a social worker. You're a Republican who's voted for Democrats, but you're not sure what you're going to do this time around. Correct?
Correct. Greetings, former Vice President Biden.
Hello.
Thank you, Mr. Stephanopoulos. In a 2012 report of the University of Pittsburgh's Institute of Politics, fracking was discussed and its possible implications for the waterways from the Commonwealth to the Gulf. Fracking has made the population sick and killed wildlife in southwest Pennsylvania. The Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and small business development centers have already begun to transition people away from fossil fuels. What industries that are not harmful to human health and the environment are you planning for Southwest Pennsylvania and the nation?
Well, first of all, I make it clear, I do not propose banning fracking. I think you have to make sure that fracking is, in fact, not emitting methane or polluting the well or dealing with what can be small earthquakes and how they're drilling. So it has to be managed very, very well, number one. Number two, what we have to do is the future rests in renewable energy. The single fastest growing energy source in the world right now, because I'm going to say something that's going to sound self-serving, but I managed the Recovery Act, and I was able to invest billions of dollars into bringing down the cost of the cost per BTU of wind and solar. So now it's cheaper than coal, it's cheaper than oil right now. And it has great, great promise. And it's also the fastest growing employer in the energy industry. And so there are a number of things that I would do immediately. Number one, there are well over 100,000 wells that are left uncapped in the region. Mm-hmm. We could hire 128,000 of these people who are working in the industry to cap these wells and get a good salary doing it now. Number one. Number two, we should be moving toward finding the new technologies that are going to be able to deal with carbon capture. So ultimately, as a transition, we moved from to a net zero emission of carbon that we're still going to be able to use, if we find the right technology, some gas to be able to, if we can carbon capture. And I think we're going to be able to move in a direction where by the year 2035, we'll be able to have net zero emissions of carbon from the creation of energy creation, that so we can move it by dealing with those. And every time we talk about global warming or the environment, the president thinks it's a joke, and I think it's jobs. Because what we're going to have happen is, you'll be able to see now, as I started to say before, I, as president, are going to invest that $600 billion we spend in government contracts only on those things that, in fact, also are not only made in America, but building an infrastructure that's clean and new. And what we have to do is focus on the transmission of energy across the country from areas relating to solar and wind. The reason is that that has not been mastered yet. I met a lot of people in Silicon Valley. The battery technology is increasing significantly, so you're going to be able to have, for example, solar on your home and a battery this, as I'm showing you here, in your basement. So when the sun doesn't shine for 5 days, you still have enough energy. So we're making significant progress. The other thing we're going to do is provide an awful lot of work. It's estimated to put close to 1 million people to work by weatherizing 4 million buildings and 2 million homes, because we'll save tons and tons of energy, or like billions of barrels of energy over time, and at the same time provide significant employment and a good union wages, prevailing wages.
Let me stick on fracking for a second.
Sure.
You said you don't want to ban fracking. As you know, it's an important issue here in Pennsylvania. Not everyone buys your denial. A member of the Boilermakers Local 154, Sean Steffi, was quoted in the New York Times today saying, "You can't have it both ways." He says, "You can't meet your goal to end fossil fuels without ending fracking." What do you say to people like Sean who doubt your denial because they think you want to keep that promise?
Well, tell them the Boilermakers overwhelmingly endorse me, okay? So the Boilermakers unions endorse me because I sat down with them in great detail with the leadership exactly what I would do. Number one. Number two, what I would do is I would stop giving tax breaks and subsidizing oil. We don't need to subsidize oil any longer, number one. We should stop that and save billions of dollars over time. What I would also do with regard to, the difference between me and the new Green Deal, they say automatically by 2030, we're going to be carbon free. Not possible.
So are you for it or against it? You say you're not for it, but in your website it says you call it a crucial framework. The Green Deal.
My deal is a crucial framework, but not the new Green Deal. The new Green Deal calls for elimination of all all non-renewable energy by 2030. You can't get there. You're going to need to be able to transition, George, to be able to transition to get to the place where we invest in new technologies that allow us to do things that get us to a place where we get to net zero emission, including in agriculture. I've laid out a detailed plan. We should be taking the plan where we allow significant more land to be put in conservation, planting deep-rooted plants which absorb carbon from the air, and in fact pay farmers to do it. We can do things like pelletize all the chicken manure and all the horse manure and cow manure, and they can be and take out the methane and use it as fertilizer and make a lot of money doing it. For example, right now down in people, when I say that, they wonder what I'm talking about. The biggest carbon sink in the world is the Amazon. More carbon absorbed from the air, diminishing global warming, in the Amazon than all the carbon emitted on a yearly basis from the United States of America, from all vehicles and all means. So we have to use our imaginations. We have to move in the direction as well, providing for electric vehicles. Electric vehicles will save billions of gallons of oil, create, estimated, not me, Wall Street, 1 million automobile jobs. But we're lagging, I mean, we're not investing. We're not doing any of the research.
Got to take another quick break. We'll be right back.
ABC News, straightforward. It's being called the most consequential election of a lifetime, the most important vote. And with so much on the line, it demands the most straightforward newsmaking, real answers, the most informed voices from all sides. The countdown is on to the vote. What will our future look like? ABC's This Week with George. It all plays out right here every Sunday.
The most consequential week yet of this hyper-political year.
Right as you get closer to casting your vote every Sunday on ABC.
Stronger. What is necessary for Chicago is a vision, actual solutions for the issues we face.
Oh boy. All people, all voices.
One Chicago, united for all.
Welcome to Disney Plus. Are you ready? Drop in and explore the action, the adventure, and the originals. There's no limit to what you'll find. These are your worlds. So come on, dive deeper into the universes you love, wherever and whenever you want them. You'll find them all here on Disney Plus.
Hello?
This is Montana Highway Patrol. You're looking for a couple of missing teenagers.
That's right. When the night last seen in a red Focus has
come. The steering wheel is getting stiff.
Lock the door.
We're fine.
Got ourselves a predicament. When the night
has come. This is what being live is all about. This is ABC News Live, the 24/7 streaming news source, ABC News. Wow. Breaking news, live events as they happen, streaming live, nonstop, straight to you. Original, on the edge, breakthrough storytelling from ABC News, National Geographic, ESPN, all designed differently for you to stream straight to any screen whenever you want, free. And imagine the most celebrated, epic live events and moments.
This is live?
All playing out right before your eyes.
See those flames behind me?
And go deeper inside the groundbreaking exclusives from the campaign trail only ABC News gets. Watch ABC News Live right now and anytime. Streaming on Roku, Hulu, Facebook, and ABCNews.com.
ABC News Live.
Streaming everywhere, right to you.
ABC News Live.
Now could be a good time to have another baby.
Are you crazy?
I'm in love with you.
Now that I said it out loud, it does sound weird.
Please stop. When I
see you were so fine, I had to remind myself to breathe. I feel something
when I see you. Let's do this.
How's your quarantine going?
Now, when it matters most, the straightforward facts. ABC News is America's number one news. Number one in the morning, number one in the evening, and the number one show on all of television. Number one in late night versus the competition. Number one in politics versus the competition. The number one daytime talk show, and number one in streaming news. Most trusted, most watched. ABC News is America's number one news.
Admit it. These days, what you need to know seems to change,
well, every day. So what can help you feel smarter, better, happier?
This is GMA3, what you need to know.
Lunchtime at 1 Eastern, 12 Central and Pacific on ABC.
Who was John Lennon?
Magical.
Brilliant.
Daring.
John was my favorite Beatle.
Now, new interviews with those who were right there with John Lennon and his last interview, all on that day.
Wow, there's life, there's hope.
The 2020 event, John Lennon, Friday night on ABC.
Welcome back to our town hall with former Vice President Joe Biden. The next question comes from Mark Hoffman, Center Valley, Pennsylvania, conservative who voted for Trump in 2016.
Welcome to Pennsylvania, Mr. Vice President.
Good to be back home. I'm from Pennsylvania.
Yes, I know. Scranton, right?
Yep.
So, peace is breaking out all over the world. Our troops are coming home. Serbia is talking to Kosovo. And the Arabs and Israelis are talking peace, which I believe is a modern-day miracle, what's going on. Does President Trump's foreign policy deserve some credit?
A little, but not a whole lot. We find ourselves in a position where we're more isolated in the world than we've ever been. Our allies are our goat alone. Our, you know, America First has made America alone. You have Iran closer to having enough nuclear material to build a bomb. North Korea has more bombs and missiles available to it. We find ourselves where our NATO allies are publicly saying they can't count on us. We're in a situation as well where in the Far East, we find ourselves in the Western Pacific, where we're isolated as well. You have Japan and South Korea at odds with one another. China is making moves. So I would say we find ourselves less secure than we've been. I do compliment the president on the deal with Israel recently. If you take a look, we're not very well trusted around the world. When 17 major nations in the world were asked who they trust more, who's the better leader, and the president came in behind both the international survey, both behind Putin as well as Xi. And look what Putin's doing. You know, you have Americans, bounties on American military's heads in Afghanistan. There are more people there now, by the way, than when we left in Afghanistan. And we find ourselves in a situation where he's talked to Putin six times, hadn't said a word to him. And NATO is on the risk of beginning to crack because they doubt our concern whether we're there. You see what's happening, everything from Belarus to Poland to Hungary, and the rise of totalitarian regimes in the world, and as well as this president embraces all the thugs in the world. I mean, he's best friends with the leader of North Korea, sending love letters. He doesn't take on Putin in any way, and he's learned the art of the steal from the art of the deal by Xi in China. So I would respectfully suggest no, there is no plan, no coherent plan for foreign policy. You know, we've always ruled. We've been most effective as a world leader, in my humble opinion, not just by the exercise of our power, the most powerful nation in the world, but the power of our example. That's what's led the rest of the world to follow us on almost everything. He's pulled out of almost every international organization. He gets laughed at when he goes to the, literally, not figuratively, when he goes to the United Nations. I mean, it's not about the president per se, it's about the nation and the lack of respect that's shown to us.
I want to get one more question in this segment, and it comes from Mika Hack. She's from State College, Pennsylvania. This is your first presidential election that you're voting.
Yes.
Hi, Mika, how are you?
I'm good, thank you. I'm the proud mom of two girls, 8 and 10. My youngest daughter is transgender. The Trump administration has attacked the rights of transgender people, banning them from military service, weakening non-discrimination protections, and even removing the word transgender from some government websites. How will you, as president, reverse this dangerous and discriminatory agenda and ensure that the lives and rights of LGBTQ people are protected under U.S. law?
I will flat out just change the law, eliminate those executive orders, number one. You may recall, I'm the guy who said, I was raised by a man who, I remember I was being dropped off. My dad was a high school educated, well-read man who was a really decent guy. And I was being dropped off to get an application in the center of our city, Wilmington, Delaware, the corporate capital of the world at the time. And these two men, I'm getting out to get an application to be a lifeguard in the African-American community because there was a big swimming pool complex. And these two men, well-dressed, leaned up and hugged one another and kissed one another. I'm getting out of the car at the light, and I turn to my dad. My dad looked at me and said, Joey, it's simple. They love each other. The idea that an 8-year-old child or a 10-year-old child decides, you know, I decided I want to be transgender. That's what I think I'd like to be. It'll make my life a lot easier. There should be zero discrimination. And what's happening is too many transgender women of color are being murdered. They're being murdered. I mean, I think it's up to now 17. Don't hold me to that number, but it's higher now.
Yeah.
And that's just this year. And so I promise you, there is no reason to suggest that there should be any right denied your daughter or daughters, whichever, one or two.
One.
Your daughter, that your other daughter has a right to be and do. None. Zero. And by the way, my son Beau passed away, was the Attorney General of the state of Delaware. He was the guy who got the first transgender law passed in the state of Delaware. And because of a young man who became a woman who worked for him in the Attorney General's office.
We've got one more segment coming up. Thank you.
And I'm
we'll
proud
be right
of
back.
You.
ABC News, straightforward. With so much at stake, so much on the line, more Americans turn here than any place else. ABC News, World News Tonight with David Muir.
We have made it through another week together.
America's most watched program across all of television.
Yes, mornings may look different these days, but where you start your day,
where you spend your mornings, where you get connected to everything that's happening.
And face it, there's a whole lot happening in our world these days.
Where you get all the breaking new information of the day to help you navigate through these times.
That's why we're here.
Good morning, sunshine.
And making sure you start your day off with a smile and some sunshine.
Good morning, America.
Good morning, America.
Good morning, America. Oh, how I love saying that. Wake me
up. Hello?
This is Montana Highway Patrol. You're looking for a couple of missing teenagers.
That's right. When the night last seen in a red Focus. Has
come. The steering wheel is getting stiff.
Lock the door.
We're fine.
No, I won't be afraid. Be afraid. Be afraid.
Got ourselves a predicament.
When the night has come.
Admit it. These days, what you need to know seems to change, well, like every day. So what can help you feel smarter, better, happier? Welcome to GMA3, What You Need to Know, the third hour of Good Morning America, lunchtime on ABC.
What's the most innovative daily news podcast out there to listen to every day? Well, the Edward R. Murrow Awards say it's Start Here, the daily news podcast from ABC News. Even the New York Times calls us a top news podcast worth listening to. So if you like getting behind the biggest news stories of the day, inside all the details, the backstory, and what will happen next, then listen to Start Here, the daily news podcast from ABC News. It's like no other news podcast out there. Even the critics agree. Listen free on Apple Podcasts.
On your carts. Get set. Let's go!
Get ready.
The team with the highest cart total could be leaving with $100,000.
To shop.
Bam, bam, bam.
Till you drop.
Oh,
me down.
Leslie Jones hosts Supermarket Sweep, premieres Sunday, October 18th on ABC.
Welcome to Disney Plus. Are you ready? Drop in and explore the action, the adventure, and the originals. There's no limit to what you'll find. These are your worlds. So come on, dive deeper into the universes you love. Wherever and whenever you want them, you'll find them all here on Disney Plus.
This is what being live is all about. This is ABC News Live, the 24/7 streaming news source from ABC News. Breaking news, live events, streaming nonstop. Original breakthrough storytelling from ABC News, National Geographic, ESPN. And it's all designed differently for you to stream straight to any screen whenever you want.
ABC News Live.
Streaming everywhere, right to you.
ABC News Live. It's that easy to go there.
Who was John Lennon?
Magical. Brilliant. Daring.
Rebel. A working class kid from Liverpool.
John was my favorite Beatle.
If he hadn't dreamed so beautifully, it wouldn't hurt so much.
Now, Friday night, new interviews with those who were right there with John Lennon and his last interview, all on that day.
While there's life, there's hope.
The 2020 event.
Yoko said, what I tell you now is top secret. You can't ever tell anyone.
John Lennon, his life, his legacy, his last days. Friday night on ABC. The Vice President and the People, a special edition of 2020. Here again, George Stephanopoulos.
And welcome back to our town hall with former Vice President Joe Biden. The next question comes from Keenan Wilson, Narberth, Pennsylvania, Democrat.
Good evening. You say that you committed to entering this race after the events of Charlottesville in 2017. I assume that that feeling that prompted you to run will not go away once the results are determined. So, hypothetically, if you lose, how will you use your platform to urge President Donald Trump and those rallying behind him towards the ideals of a more perfect union?
Well, to be very honest with you, I think that's very hard. He is not, things have not lent themselves to him learning from what's happened, what's gone before. Instead of being chastened by being one of the few presidents, the only president to be impeached and then have a member of his own party vote to expel him, it emboldened him. So, but what I will do, I'll go back to being a professor at the University of Pennsylvania and making the case that I've been made and at the Biden Institute at the University of Delaware, focusing on these same issues relating to what constitutes decency and honor in this country. It's the thing that got me involved in public life to begin with. As a kid, I moved from Scranton, where there were no African Americans, and moved down to Claymont, Delaware. And in Delaware, we have the eighth largest black population as a percent of population. It was an epiphany for me, seeing what was going on. And I got deeply involved. I'm no great shakes. I don't mean I wasn't John Lewis. I don't mean to imply that. But it's the thing that's motivated. My dad used to have an expression, for real. He said, everyone's entitled to be treated with dignity. Everybody. And it was real. Everybody is. And so whether I'm a defeated candidate for president back teaching or I'm elected president, it is a major element of everything that I'm about because it reflects who we are as a nation. And it's what makes us, this is every single solitary generation. The dial has moved closer and closer and more to inclusion. And we are a country that is a country of slaves who came here 400 years ago, indigenous people, and everyone else is an immigrant. And we're a diverse country. And unless we are able to treat people equally, we're just never going to meet our potential. But I think the American people want to see that happen. I think they're ready to see it happen. And I tell you one thing, if I'm elected president, you will not hear me race baiting, you'll not hear me dividing, you'll hear me trying to unify. And unify with, bring people together. When I said I was running because I wanted to unify the country, people said, well, there were the old days. We better be able to do it again.
Agreed.
We better be able to do it again.
Mr. Vice President, if you lose, what will that say to you about where America is today?
Well, it could say that I'm a lousy candidate and I didn't do a good job. But I think, I hope that it doesn't say that we are as racially, ethnically, and religiously at odds with one another as it appears the president wants us to be. Usually, you know, the president's, in my view, with all due respect, has been divide and conquer, the way he does better if he splits us. There's division. And I think people need hope. I think, look, George, I've never been more optimistic about the prospects for this country than I am today. And I really mean that. I think the people are ready. They understand what's at stake. And it's not about Democrat or Republican. If I get elected, you know, I'm running as a proud Democrat, but I'm going to be an American president. I'm going to take care of those who voted against me as well as those who voted for me, for real. That's what presidents do. We got to heal this nation because we have the greatest opportunity of any country in the world to own the 21st century, and we can't do it divided.
One more break. We'll be right back.
Welcome to Disney Plus. Are you ready? Drop in and explore the action, the adventure, and the originals. There's no limit to what you'll find. These are your worlds. So come on, dive deeper into the universes you love, wherever and whenever you want them. You'll find them all here on Disney Plus.
Right now, at this defining moment in America, with so much on the line,
we gon' be all right, we gon' be all right.
From ABC News, Turning Point, the groundbreaking special Nightline series, taking over, taking on, this moment for America, my America, your America, our America. This is Turning Point, the special Nightline series.
We gon' be all right.
Late night on ABC.
The waters of the Outer Banks are unforgiving and full of riches for the fishermen who dare. The best of the Northern Fleet are heading south. But the locals know where the giants lie. And if you thought the waters were unforgiving, wait until the battle begins.
Wicked Tuna Outer Banks, new episodes Sundays at 9 on National Geographic.
The team with the highest card total could be leaving with $100,000.
To shop.
Bam, bam, bam.
Till you drop.
Oh, mommy down.
Leslie Jones hosts Supermarket Sweep. Premieres Sunday, October 18th on ABC.
It's being called the most consequential election of a lifetime, the most important vote, and with so much on the line, it demands the most straightforward, news-making, real answers, the most informed voices from all sides. The countdown is on to the vote. What will our future look like? ABC's This Week with George. It all plays out right here every Sunday.
The most consequential week yet of this hyper-political year.
Right as you get closer to casting your vote every Sunday on ABC.
Now could be a good time to have another baby.
Are you crazy? I'm in love with you. Now that I said it out loud, it does sound weird.
I feel so.
Please stop.
When I see.
You were so fine, I had to remind myself to breathe.
I feel something when I see you.
Let's do this.
How's your quarantine going?
I know what happened, and I'm not guilty.
Why the fascination with criminal trials? Figure out what's really out there.
She revealed she had murdered his family.
I know in my heart they did this.
It's the time of suspicion.
The ending's really tough.
You don't know whether truth is going to be difficult to find unless you try to find it.
Tomorrow, get ready for an all-time high with all-time low. With an amazing performance for you.
I'm wondering why do all the monsters come out
tomorrow on Good Morning America's Concert Series, sponsored by CarMax.
And we are wrapping up our town hall with former Vice President Joe Biden. Mr. Vice President, as you know, President Trump had a town hall meeting tonight as well. During that town hall meeting, he was asked several times whether he took a COVID test the day of your last debate. You're supposed to have another debate a week from tonight. Just two quick questions. Do you expect that debate to happen? Will you demand that President Trump take a test that day and that it be negative before you debate?
Yeah, by the way, before I came up here, I took another test. I've been taking it every day, the deep test, you know, the one they go on both. And because I wanted to be able, if I had not passed that test, I didn't want to come here and not, you know, expose anybody. And I just think it's just decency to be able to determine whether or not you are, you're clear. And it's not, I'm less concerned about me than the people. The guys at the cameras, the people working in the, you know, the Secret Service guys you drive up with, all those people. And so, yes, I believe he will do that. Look, I'm going to abide by what the commission rules call for. I was prepared to debate him remotely, which was supposed to happen, and he said he wouldn't do that, you know, a virtual debate. Our town hall, he didn't want to do that. I didn't set those rules. The commission set the rules. So whatever rules they set, and I'm confident that the Cleveland Clinic is the one overseeing it, I think they're going to not let happen what happened last time. They're going to demand that it's safe.
But you expect to be there?
Oh, I expect to be there.
Mr. Vice President, thank you for your time tonight. Thank to all the questioners here. It was really terrific questions. I think you did a service to our democracy tonight. Thank you very much. I want to go back to my colleague, David Muir in New York.
All right, George, thank you. So there you have it, the ABC News Town Hall with former Vice President Joe Biden, just 19 days until the election in this country. Of course, voting already underway. More than 18 million Americans have voted. Tonight, as you heard from the vice president there, there was supposed to be a presidential debate. President Trump pulled out of that debate when the commission wanted a virtual debate after the COVID outbreak at the White House. Joe Biden had agreed to do that instead, then doing the town hall here with ABC. And the president, in a late move this week, agreeing to the town hall in another network, sort of split screen in America tonight. We did hear the president and the vice president get pressed on several topics tonight. The vice president in Philadelphia now talking to those voters, socially distanced in the audience, Republicans, Democrats, and some undecideds. They asked him about the pandemic, whether he'd take a vaccine if ready before year's end. He said yes, if the scientists are behind it. He was asked if he would raise taxes on the wealthy and on corporate America, even in a recovery. He said yes. There was a deeply personal exchange. A young voter asking Biden why young black Americans should vote for him. He made his case. He was asked about packing the Supreme Court. And I want to bring in Mary Bruce, who is outside the Constitution Center there in Philadelphia tonight, because Mary, you and I have been watching all week the confirmation hearing of Judge Amy Coney Barrett, President Trump's pick to replace Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Biden said tonight that it depends on how this is handled, saying Americans are already voting. He was pressed on what that meant, how this was handled. He was pressed, will he have a position on packing the court before Election Day?
David, Joe Biden tonight notably went further on this issue than he has before. He has been pressed on this repeatedly, and while he still isn't giving a clear answer on whether he would expand the court, saying he's, quote, not a fan of court packing, tonight he notably didn't rule it out, saying that he will have a clear answer on this by Election Day after the confirmation hearings for Amy Coney Barrett, saying that Americans have a right to know. But David, of course, voting is already well underway. 19 days to go. Nearly 18 million Americans have cast their ballot. So the question tonight is, what is Joe Biden waiting for on this?
And Mary, stick with us on this. He did say he'd have a position before Election Day, and we're looking at live pictures right now interacting with voters in that debate hall. He was the one who first agreed to doing a town hall after the debate was canceled. This campaign certainly knows that they think these are good opportunities for the vice president to make his case by interacting with American voters.
David, here tonight we saw something that we really haven't seen very often in this campaign that has been upended by the pandemic. Joe Biden having an opportunity to interact directly with voters, answering their questions about what matters most to them as they make this choice. His campaign feels that he shines in these moments, that he does best when he is able to speak directly with voters. I know that Joe Biden misses having more of these opportunities. And I was struck tonight, when you take a step back, how much Joe Biden tonight really talked about his plans. There was a lot of deep diving that he was doing into his policy proposals going forward. This was a night largely about Joe Biden, and actually, surprisingly, not a lot about his opponent. He didn't really speak that much about Donald Trump. This was a night for him, Joe Biden, to connect with voters and talk about how he would be changing their futures.
Yeah, as you rightly point out, Mary, a lot more about policy and plans moving forward than we heard from really either candidate in that first debate after the shouting match sort of erupted and really never ended as that debate played out in front of America. As the vice president continues to talk with voters there, we also know President Trump in Florida tonight pressed in his own town hall on whether he was tested for COVID the day of that first presidential debate. He's pressed a number of times on this. If he took a test on the day of that debate, he said, I probably did, but said he doesn't take a test every day. He was also asked if he was ever warned that this would be the greatest national security threat of his administration, coronavirus, which has been reported that he was warned. He said he wasn't warned, but that he knew it was a big threat. At the same time, the president said, I didn't want to panic this country. I didn't want to go out there and say everyone's going to die. Pressed on whether or not there's a middle ground, whether or not he could have leveled with the American people, he said, no, there's no middle ground. I want to bring in Rachel Scott. She's live with us from Florida tonight where that town hall is playing out, because as we're looking at pictures from Philadelphia, we know the president tonight was pressed on that New York Times reporting on his taxes. Rachel, he was asked if he ever really did pay just $750 in federal income taxes. He was also asked about that reported debt of about $400 million, asked who does he owe that money to.
David, he was, and he was asked whether or not he owes that money to foreign entities, and he said, quote, not that I know of. The president downplayed the amount of debt that he is in. He seemingly said that it's just a tiny fraction of what he is worth. David, I was struck tonight about how much the president was on defense. The president walked into tonight's town hall, behind double digits in the polls at a time when he is under fire for his handling of the pandemic, and the president tonight spent much of his time on defense, defending his handling of not only the pandemic, issues like healthcare, as well as the economy. What we did not hear a lot of tonight, just 19 days out from Election Day, was the president talking about his rival, Joe Biden. And the president tonight was forced to confront key questions about his health. Whether or not he tested negative on that debate day is a lingering question. One, the president even said tonight that he could not even remember, could not even recall whether or not he was tested for coronavirus on the day of the debate. The president also tonight, David, downplaying the coronavirus, insisting that we are rounding the corner at a time when the CDC predicts that we may record 240,000 deaths just 1 week after Election Day. David?
Rachel Scott with us from Florida tonight. And Rachel, as she points out, the president being asked, was he tested on that debate night? In stark contrast to the image you're seeing in Philadelphia right now, former Vice President Joe Biden with his mask back on, telling George just a short time ago that he was tested again today, daily testing now, saying he wouldn't want to put anyone in that room at risk, and that he would follow the debate commission's rules, but expect that everyone be tested before that final presidential debate still scheduled for next week. I want to bring in our chief White House correspondent, Jonathan Carl, watching this split screen in America, as I mentioned, John. Very different answers in both town halls. I'm curious, John, if you saw anything tonight that really moves the needle in any significant way with Americans already voting.
There are so few Americans that are undecided at this point, David. This is such a deeply divided country. But watching these two town halls, and I tried to watch them, if you can imagine, both at the same time, quite a task. And this is such a strange campaign. We have heard very little from either of these two men about what they would actually do over the next 4 years. And Biden has famously dodged this question of expanding the Supreme Court, and George really pushed him on this, and we have what appears to be a commitment that after the Amy Coney Barrett vote, he will tell the American people. He said voters have a right to know where he stands on expanding the court. On the other side, Donald Trump was asked a very simple question by a voter, what is your plan to deal with health care and rising health care costs? And it was abundantly clear that he has absolutely no plan. This is something he has had nearly four years in office to come up with. He basically said that what he has done is he's done away with the individual mandate with Obamacare, and then talked a little bit more about how Obamacare is not a good thing and we need something better, but absolutely nothing about what he would actually do on health care.
And John, as you've been reporting, he's been saying for a very long time now, I'll have that plan in a couple of weeks, and still no plan.
Still no plan.
John Carl watching both debates. We thank you. We know you were watching the ABC one in front of you while you were trying to watch the one on the other network at the same time, and we sure do appreciate that. Our analysts are standing by, of course, from both ends of the political spectrum, our powerhouse political team. Our coverage of the ABC News Town Hall continues right here in a moment.
ABC News, straightforward. Welcome to Disney Plus. Are you ready? Drop in and explore the action, the adventure, and the originals. There's no limit to what you'll find. These are your worlds. So come on, dive deeper into the universes you love. Wherever and whenever you want them, you'll find them all here on Disney Plus.
Who was John Lennon?
Magical. Brilliant. Daring.
Rebel. A working class kid from Liverpool.
John was my favorite Beatle.
If he hadn't dreamed so beautifully, it wouldn't hurt so much.
Now, Friday night, new interviews with those who were right there with John Lennon and his last interview, all on that day.
While there's life, there's hope.
The 2020 event.
Yoko said, what I tell you now is top secret. You can't ever tell anyone.
John Lennon, his life, his legacy, his last days. Friday night on ABC.
I know what happened, and I'm not guilty.
Why the fascination with criminal trials? Figure out what's really out there.
She revealed she had murdered his family.
I know in my heart they did this.
It's the time of suspicion.
The ending's really tough.
You don't know whether truth is going to be difficult to find unless you try to find it.
COVID-19 was a wake-up call. There are so many more pandemics that could be just around the corner. Viruses literally travel through human populations. What we've got to do is go to those places where the virus begins its journey. Masks on?
Yep.
Masks on.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my God.
This is the exact way in which a new virus could start.
Virus Hunters, special event, Sunday, November 1st at 9 on National Geographic.
On your carts! Get set! Let's go!
Get ready.
The team with the highest card total could be leaving with $100,000.
To shop.
Bam, bam, bam!
Till you drop.
Down.
Leslie Jones hosts Supermarket Sweep, premieres Sunday, October 18th on ABC.
It's being called the most consequential election of a lifetime, the most important vote, and with so much on the line, it demands the most straightforward newsmaking, real answers, the most informed voices from all sides. The countdown is on to the vote. What will our future look like? ABC's This Week with George. It all plays out right here every Sunday.
The most consequential week yet of this hyper-political year.
Right as you get closer to casting your vote every Sunday on ABC.
Hello?
This is Montana Highway Patrol. You're looking for a couple of missing teenagers.
That's right. When the night last seen in a red Focus. Has
come. The steering wheel is getting stiff.
Lock the door. We're fine.
No, I won't be afraid. Be afraid. Be afraid.
Got ourselves a predicament.
When the night.
With so much on the line, ABC News, America's number one news, is right there for you live on Hulu with stories of strength, stories of hope. Because now, when it matters most,
Hulu has live news.
Hulu has live news.
Hulu has live news. And that news is ABC News.
ABC News Live on Hulu.
ABC News Live on Hulu.
Watch the news you need.
Thanks so much for streaming with us.
Streaming to all Hulu subscribers right now. With so much at stake, so much on the line, more Americans turn here than any place else. ABC News, World News Tonight with David Muir.
We have made it through another week together.
America's most watched program across all of television.
But to ABC News live coverage. The Vice President and the people, our town hall tonight, the Constitution Center there in Philadelphia. Live pictures. The Vice President still interacting with voters there, something his campaign certainly believes is a strong suit for the former Vice President. I want to get right to our roundtable, a virtual roundtable of sorts. Rahm Emanuel, ABC News contributor, of course, former mayor of Chicago. Mr. Mayor, what did you make of the Vice President's performance tonight? You saw George press him there on court packing. He said he'll have an answer for the American people before the election. That's going to make some news.
David, I would tilt the other way rather than any specific policy, and you see it right now. The incredible respect that came from him to the questionnaires. He had a dialogue and a conversation. There's a decency to them as citizens deserving the answer. That's why he's still staying behind and doing another hour. I think it reminds me of 1992 when Bill Clinton went towards a questionnaire and George Bush was looking at his watch. It was that empathy and respect that came across to the citizens, and you can even watch it still now happening. So to me, any particular issue, that's what you're pinpointing. I think what you're looking at is somebody who actually appreciates his fellow citizens, and it captures the moment this country is worried about, the kind of who we are as a country and coming together, and this is capturing. And I actually think I, like John, watched the other debate, and I would both of them simultaneously, and you got one of clarity versus I actually do think one of chaos, where the president still can't answer what his health care plan is. So to me, that's what came across, was this, the character of Joe Biden, and that's his main selling point beyond any issue.
Rahm, thank you. You heard that. Sarah Fagan, ABC News contributor, Republican strategist. Rahm making the case that it won't be any particular issue or policy that comes out of this as a headline from the former vice president. Instead, the overall picture of him interacting with voters there. Do you agree?
I think he did help himself tonight. And I agree with Rahm. I mean, look, Joe Biden is a very decent person. But what I also saw tonight was the conflict he faces, the balancing act he tries to do every day as the leader of the Democratic Party. We heard it. We heard it. I don't like court packing. I do support fracking. You know, these are contrast to things that he has on his website, the fracking issue. On the court packing, what I heard is he's probably going to do it because the base of his party is going to push him. You know, this is a tough call for voters, right? Because they want, they like the decency of Joe Biden, but I think they know what he really represents is a much more liberal America.
But Sarah, let me ask you this. In pulling out of that second debate because they wanted it to be virtual, in President Trump's decision not to do it, was that somewhat of a gift to the Biden campaign so that they could have a town hall where they're interacting with voters in such a personal way?
Well, look, these events can be risky for candidates, but I thought Joe Biden handled himself very well. He's very, very good with people. We saw that tonight. And to some degree, the Trump campaign kind of put out early on that, there's a senility, he's old, he stumbles. And we didn't see that tonight. He was pretty composed and articulate.
All right, Sarah Fagan with us tonight as well. Sarah, thank you. I want to get right to Yvette Simpson, also an ABC News contributor, CEO of Democracy for America. Yvette, great to see you as always. What did you make of the vice president's performance tonight?
Hey, David. It's the best I've seen him. I think he did a great job, not just directly answering questions, talking about specific policies, and I think he took that very hard stance of acknowledging that he was wrong about the 1994 crime bill, which I think was a great position for him to take. So I think it was a great night for him, and I do think he's walking a tightrope, I think in part because if you're the leader of a party, you have to take everybody's opinions to bear. We have not seen that with Donald Trump. He's not listening to most Republicans or most people, and I actually do respect Joe Biden for, I think, having a broader perspective, listening to all sides, and actually being willing to adjust his own thinking to the realities of the day.
Yvette, thank you. I want to get into Matt Dowd, ABC News chief political analyst. And Matt, to Sarah's point, on a lot of those issues, Joe Biden trying to walk the line, he's trying to reach out to some of the moderate Republicans they're convinced they can get to come over to their side.
What would you say to lifelong Republicans?
Well, the best presidents and the best candidates have to always walk a line. George W. Bush, who Sarah and I both worked for, had to walk a line between many of his moderate stances and the conservative part of the party. Bill Clinton had to walk a line. The best ones do that. I think the way to judge these things is, what is their imperative? What is each candidate's imperative when they approach these things and come in? As we saw 2 weeks ago, Joe Biden and Donald Trump, Joe Biden was 7 points ahead 2 weeks ago. He's now 10 points ahead. And so all Joe Biden had to do tonight to win this thing and move forward is make the voters who already are voting for him or already want to vote for him comfortable in that choice. And I think he did that. Donald Trump has a much harder one, which is persuade Biden voters to move to him.
All right. Less than 3 weeks to go. Matt Dowder, thanks to you as well. Some closing thoughts from some of my trusted teammates here at ABC in just a moment as our live coverage of the town hall with Joe Biden in Philadelphia continues right after this.
ABC News, straightforward. It's being called the most consequential election of a lifetime, the most important vote, and with so much on the line, it demands the most straightforward, newsmaking, real answers, the most informed voices from all sides. The countdown is on to the vote. What will our future look like? ABC's This Week with George. It all plays out right here every Sunday.
The most consequential week yet of this hyper-political year.
Right as you get closer to casting your vote every Sunday on ABC. With so much at stake, so much on the line, more Americans turn here than any place else. ABC News, World News Tonight with David Muir.
We have made it through another week together.
America's most watched program across all of television.
I wanna be strong.
What is necessary for Chicago is a vision, actual solutions for the issues we face.
Oh boy.
All people, all voices.
One Chicago. United for all.
This is what being live is all about. This is ABC News Live, the 24/7 streaming news source, ABC News. Breaking news, live events as they happen, streaming live, nonstop, straight to you. Original, on the edge, breakthrough storytelling from ABC News, National Geographic, ESPN, all designed differently for you to stream straight to any screen whenever you want, free. And imagine the most celebrated, epic live events and moments.
This is live?
All playing out right before your eyes.
See those flames behind me?
And go deeper inside the groundbreaking exclusives from the campaign trail. Only ABC News gets. Watch ABC News Live right now and anytime. Streaming on Roku, Hulu, Facebook, and abcnews.com.
ABC News Live.
Streaming everywhere right to you.
ABC News Live.
What's the most innovative daily news podcast out there to listen to every day? Well, the Edward R. Murrow Awards say it's Start Here, the daily news podcast from ABC News. Even the New York Times calls us a top news podcast worth listening to. So if you like getting behind the biggest news stories of the day, inside all the details, the backstory, and what will happen next, then listen to Start Here, the daily news podcast from ABC News. It's like no other news podcast out there. Even the critics agree. Listen free on Apple Podcasts.
Welcome to Disney Plus. Are you ready? Drop in and explore. The action. The adventure. And the originals. There's no limit to what you'll find. These are your worlds. So come on. Dive deeper into the universes you love. Wherever and whenever you want them. You'll find them all here on Disney Plus.
Yes, mornings may look different these days, but where you start your day,
where you spend your mornings, where you get connected to everything that's happening.
And face it, there's a whole lot happening in our world these days.
Where you get all the breaking new information of the day to help you navigate through these times.
That's why we're here.
Good morning, sunshine.
And making sure you start your day off with a smile and some sunshine.
Good morning, America.
Good morning, America.
Good morning, America. Oh, how I love saying that.
Wake me up.
On your carts. Get set. Let's go.
Get ready.
The team with the highest card total could be leaving with $100,000.
To shop.
Bam, bam, bam.
Till you drop.
Oh, mommy down.
Leslie Jones hosts Supermarket Sweep. Premiere Sunday, October 18th on ABC.
The world may feel out of your control, but your happiness doesn't have to be. Learn the secrets to happiness. Listen to the 10% Happier podcast, free on Apple Podcasts.
John Lennon, his life, his legacy, his last days.
While there's life, there's hope.
New interviews and his last interview. The new 2020 event, Friday night on ABC.
As we continue to watch that room in Philadelphia, the vice president taking questions. Even after the town hall, Byron Pitts of Nightline, what did you make of tonight?
David, one of the telling moments for me was that young black voter who talked about the lack of enthusiasm for Joe Biden at this point. It was an issue that hurt Hillary Clinton when she ran for president. And I believe it'll be an issue for Joe Biden. It's a gap he has to close. It isn't enough for many voters that he's not Donald Trump.
He said, I hope I answered your question to that young voter as well. Martha Raddatz, you and I have done so many debates together, but town halls are so different when you can have more of a conversation with the American voter.
Exactly right. And this is what Joe Biden loves. We'll probably all be in bed before Joe Biden is out of that hall. This was really his moment tonight. But the real test, David, will be next week. He won't get some of those friendly questions from those town hall people. He will have a combative President Trump, and you can guarantee he will be coming straight for him, David.
You've witnessed it before, being the moderator in the room. And Terry Moran, nothing is predictable about 2020. And look what we had tonight, a split screen here in America.
You know, David, Donald Trump will probably measure victory by ratings. The Trump show has been the Trump presidency, but the voters may look at it differently. It is essentially an opportunity for them to re-up the Trump show or to go with what the Biden presidency might be. And I think Joe Biden did make a case it would be a return to normalcy.
Terry, thank you. I'll be right back.
COVID-19 was a wake-up call. There are so many more pandemics that could be just around the corner. Viruses literally travel through human populations. What we've got to do is go to those places where the virus begins its journey.
Masks on?
Yep.
Masks on.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my God.
This is the exact way in which a new virus could start.
Virus Hunters, special event, Sunday, November 1st at 9 on National Geographic.
Now could be a good time to have another baby.
Are you crazy? I'm in love with you.
Now that I said it out loud, it does sound weird.
Please stop. When I
see. You were so fine, I had to remind myself to breathe. I feel something
when I see you. Let's do this.
How's your quarantine going?
Who was John Lennon?
Magical. Brilliant.
Daring.
Rebel.
A working class kid from Liverpool.
John was my favorite Beatle.
If he hadn't dreamed so beautifully, it wouldn't hurt so much.
Now, Friday night, new interviews with those who were right there with John Lennon and his last interview, all on that day.
While there's life, there's hope.
The 2020 event.
Yoko said, what I tell you now is top secret. You can't ever tell anyone.
John Lennon, his life, his legacy, his last days. Friday night on ABC. Now, when it matters most, the straightforward facts. ABC News is America's number one news. Number one in the morning, number one in the evening, and the number one show on all of television. Number one in late night versus the competition. Number one in politics versus the competition. The number one daytime talk show. And number one in streaming news. Most trusted, most watched. ABC News is America's number one news. With so much at stake, so much on the line, more Americans turn here than any place else. ABC News, World News Tonight with David Muir.
We have made it through another week together.
America's most watched program across all of television.
Right now, at this defining moment in America, with so much on the line. From ABC News, a groundbreaking month-long event. Every night, taking on this moment for America. Turning Point, the Nightline event. Late night on ABC.
It's being called the most consequential election of a lifetime, the most important vote, and with so much on the line, it demands the most straightforward newsmaking, real answers, the most informed voices from all sides. The countdown is on to the vote. What will our future look like? ABC's This Week with George. It all plays out right here every Sunday.
The most consequential week yet of this hyper-political year.
Right as you get closer to casting your vote every Sunday on ABC.
Breaking news, context, analysis.
And no shouting. The time is now for ABC News Live.
Get it streaming everywhere, right to you.
The Vice President and the People, a special edition of 2020. Here again, David Muir.
A very different night playing out in this country. Instead of the second planned presidential debate, instead a town hall with Joe Biden in Philadelphia, a separate town hall with the president in Florida. Both have committed to that final debate 1 week from now. You heard Vice President Biden saying he expects the president to be tested before that debate. I'm David Muir. Good night.
With so much at stake, so much on the line, more Americans turn here than any place else. ABC News, World News Tonight with David Muir.
We have made it through another week together.
America's most watched program across all of television.
Yes, mornings may look different these days, but where you start your day,
where you spend your mornings, where you get connected to everything that's happening.
And face it, there's a whole lot happening in our world these days.
Where you get all the breaking new information of the day to help you navigate through these times.
That's why we're here.
Good morning, sunshine.
And making sure you start your day off with a smile and some sunshine.
Good morning, America.
Good morning, America.
Good morning, America. Oh, how I love saying that.
Hello?
This is Montana Highway Patrol. You're looking for a couple of missing teenagers.
That's right. When the night last seen in a red Focus.
The steering wheel is getting stiff.
Lock the door. We're fine.
No, I won't be afraid. Be afraid. Be afraid.
Got ourselves a predicament.
When the night.
Admit it. These days, what you need to know seems to change, well, like every day. So what can help you feel smarter, better, happier? Welcome to GMA3, What You Need to Know, the third hour of Good Morning America, lunchtime on ABC.
What's the most innovative daily news podcast out there to listen to every day? Well, the Edward R. Murrow Awards say it's Start Here, the daily news podcast from ABC News. Even the New York Times calls us a top news podcast worth listening to. So if you like getting behind the biggest news stories of the day, inside all the details, the backstory, and what will happen next, then listen to Start Here, the daily news podcast from ABC News. It's like no other news podcast out there. Even the critics agree. Listen free on Apple Podcasts.
On your carts. Get set. Let's go!
Get ready.
The team with the highest card total could be leaving with $100,000.
To shop.
Bam, bam, bam!
Till you drop.
Oh, mommy down!
Leslie Jones hosts Supermarket Sweep. Premieres Sunday, October 18th on ABC.
Welcome to Disney Plus. Are you ready? Drop in and explore. The action. The adventure. And the originals. There's no limit to what you'll find. These are your worlds. So come on. Dive deeper into the universes you love. Wherever and whenever you want them. You'll find them all here on Disney Plus.
This is what being live is all about. This is ABC News Live, the 24/7 streaming news source from ABC News. Breaking news, live events, streaming nonstop. Original breakthrough storytelling from ABC News, National Geographic, ESPN. And it's all designed differently for you to stream straight to any screen whenever you want.
ABC News Live.
Streaming everywhere, right to you. ABC News Live. It's that easy to go there.
Who was John Lennon?
Magical. Brilliant.
Daring.
Rebel.
A working class kid from Liverpool.
John was my favorite Beatle.
If he hadn't dreamed so beautifully, it wouldn't hurt so much.
Now, Friday night, new interviews with those who were right there with John Lennon and his last interview, all on that day.
While there's life, there's hope.
The 2020 event.
Yoko said, what I tell you now is top secret. You can't ever tell anyone.
John Lennon, his life, his legacy, his last days. Friday night on ABC.
Welcome back. While the president was taking voter questions tonight at a town hall in Miami, Joe Biden took questions from uncommitted voters at a town hall in Philadelphia, right here at ABC. A powerhouse roundtable here to weigh in. Matt, let's begin with you. Two very different tones tonight from both candidates. President Trump aggressively tackling the issues on NBC in a contentious town hall, and Joe Biden with a calmer, more measured performance on ABC. Matt, whose approach worked, do you think?
Joe Biden's by far. I mean, I think when we're in the midst of such chaos in the country and everything that's going on, from the pandemic to the economy, racial injustice, of climate change, all of that, I think voters want and desire somebody more calm, considered, clear. And I think by any standard, Joe Biden's town hall and performance at his town hall was far more on the side of calm and clear than on the side of chaos and more division and more argument. So on that standard, which is where I think the country is today, which is why I think Joe Biden has the lead he does, Biden won that standoff.
The president has lost support among senior citizens, a key group for him in 2016. He was in Florida tonight, and the state is a true battleground this year. Rahm, how does he win back senior citizens, and why has Biden's approach to the virus resonated?
Well, a couple things I would say that I'm not sure the president can do that. He's tried a number of things, trying to do law and order to culture war, and in fact, telling seniors that they were basically dispensable. When you look at everything he's done on COVID, that is the message he has sent them. And Joe Biden is a reassuring voice for them. He will be the first Democrat since Al Gore in 2000 to win senior votes. And here's the thing. Trump made a huge mistake tonight, letting Joe Biden have his own moment. Big tactical mistake. You know, in campaigns, number one rule, you got to do everything you got to do, and you got to hope your opponent does everything they did. Joe Biden got a real gift from Donald Trump today. And two, as I said earlier, chaos and confusion is on one side. Calm and compassion and clarity is on the other side. And that contrast, because at the end of the day, what the voters are looking for is somebody who will bring the country together. Joe Biden is scratching their emotional itch right now.
President Trump was evasive on the coronavirus, saying he didn't know when he took his last test before getting sick, saying he did not remember being briefed by his national security advisor on the severity of the disease, and still calling into question the effectiveness of face masks. So, Sarah, how was his approach to the virus playing across the country?
Well, I think on town, he doesn't get great marks, candidly. And part of it is because he's inconsistent. That's a simple question. Did you get the test on the day of the debate or not? He could have answered that. Now, I will say on the substance of actually fighting the virus, on, you know, therapeutics, on record-breaking vaccine research, on, you know, making sure that the country has enough PPE and ventilators and all the things that we need to do to help people recover from this disease when they get it, his administration has done pretty well. He would be better to talk about those things and have one very kind of clear, simple, consistent statement about how Americans should protect themselves when out in public.
Joe Biden was pressed tonight on his tax plan that will raise corporate taxes and taxes on the wealthy, but critics say this could hurt the economy more than help. Yvette, will this plan help or hurt Biden?
You know, I think Biden was pretty clear today. I was actually glad when he reached into his jacket and pulled out the notes to make sure that he had the right numbers, even saying that Wall Street agrees that his plan will add more jobs. You know, I agree that we actually improve the economy by helping those in the middle so that they have the resources to be able to push our economy up rather than trickle down. And so I think he did a really great job, which he wasn't able to do in the debate because he kept getting interrupted, at talking about, one, how much money he's going to unlock by making sure the wealthiest Americans and corporations pay their fair share, but also putting more money back into middle Americans and lower wealth Americans so that they have the money they need to invest in the economy and build themselves back up. So I think actually his plan is great, and I think he did a great job of articulating that today using real numbers. He got real clear answers out, and I think he did a wonderful job.
Donald Trump declined to condemn the conspiracy movement QAnon tonight, saying he didn't know much about it. Sarah, why is he still not disavowing this widely discredited idea?
Yeah, I didn't get to see that, but this has come up before, and to me, I don't understand this one. There's really, this is a softball, frankly, in politics, which is there's no place for these nutty, crazy ideas in American politics. You know, he overthinks these questions sometimes, Byron. You know, he's thinking about some individual who's on the internet and reading this stuff, and they're probably a good person, but they've for whatever reason, you know, ascribed to this philosophy. This isn't complicated. It's crazy. Just say it.
It's funny you make the point that he was overthinking. That is an argument I think you often hear made in President Trump's favor, him overthinking something. But Sarah, to that point, he's had similar issues in disavowing other groups, right? White supremacist groups, and he comes back later and cleans it up. Why, on what seems like to most reasonable people, easy things to knock down, why does he continue to struggle?
You know, I think that he turns this into a battle with the press. You know, this turns into, why would you ask me this question? You know, what people who are close to the president will say is he's offended by these questions. Like, of course I'm against white supremacy. Who is not against white supremacy? And so, you know, again, you know, whether you want to use the word overthink or, you know, just too confrontational, you know, he takes the wrong lesson from the back and forth that he has on these exchanges with journalists. He should just shut it down and move on to something substantive, where I think he has a better record than Joe Biden on most issues.
Sure. President Trump is in trouble with female voters and clearly trying to appeal to them now. He begged them to like him this week, and tonight dodged the question when asked if he would like to see Roe v. Wade overturned. 4 years ago, he said he wanted it to be overturned. Matt, is this an effective appeal to women?
I mean, Donald Trump's appeal to women on this? No, it's not. I think most every American knows that Donald Trump wants to get rid of Roe versus Wade, which is an incredibly unpopular position among the general public. I think what the problem women have to goes to something that Rahm said and something I said earlier. It's the way he conducts himself. It's how he acts. And I think they've seen this behavior in other people in their lives, especially by men, who they feel are bullied and push and don't give them a word. And so it's not about a particular issue stance that Donald Trump will ever be able to change a woman's mind that is opposed to him. It's his way he acts and the way he talks. And that, for Donald Trump at this point in his life, is exceedingly difficult to change.
Now, listening to all of you, the tone of our conversation tonight is that for President Trump at this point, it's all uphill and he's on roller skates. So, Rahm, I start with you. Make the case in what he can do, will do, could do between now and Election Day to pull this out.
Hold on. I got to get the image of him going uphill in roller skates out of my head to answer that question. And I do want to say it's not the issue of Roe v. Wade about women. His problem is when you call another candidate, a woman, a monster, and you start ridiculing the governor of Michigan, also a woman whose life was just threatened, and you're 30 points down about women, that is not going to help you narrow that gap. Look, Donald Trump, after 3.5 years of being the president, there's a simple question when you run for re-election. Do you want to play him or do you want to trade him? And you look at everything we're going, and already 18 million, 19 million voters have already cast ballots. It's pretty clear where the country is. They want to trade him. So when you say, can he do something different? At this point, I could have said that in the last 6 months, yes. Right now, he needs Biden to do something for him to change it. Donald Trump, the die is cast, the architecture is there, the mold is there, and it's being filled up. So I don't think he can do anything, actually, to change it. He has to hope Biden does something that would change it in his favor, and I don't see that happening, especially after tonight, where I think Joe Biden did an exceptional job advancing his campaign.
That same question to you. What do you think, what makes you nervous that President Trump might be able to do between now and Election Day to pull this out?
You know, I agree with Rahm in that I don't know that Donald Trump is fundamentally going to change who he is, which I think is what's required for him to get out of this hole. He gets opportunities either in debates where he's combative or on stages by himself where he says things that he can't take back, which are ridiculous. I think his key, and I think this is what he's pushing, is voter suppression. And that's the thing that we're fighting against. He fully intends to steal this election. You know, we've got battles across states, litigation that are happening to make sure votes are counted. They're trying to take away people's vote. And so I think Trump is, you know, in his last-ditch effort. He's getting out in Miami. He's dancing around with no mask on. He's trying to get his folks hyped up. But I think he knows at the end of the day, the only way he wins this is if he steals it, which is why I think this Amy Coney Barrett nomination is one way that he expects to do that. And of course, all of the things that the secretaries of state who are Republican who support him are doing as well. I don't think he has a chance, if this is a full and fair election, to win at this point.
Sarah, he's your party standard bearer. He's got less than 3 weeks to do it. What does he need to do?
Well, I think his best path to closing the race, I think, is to really focus on the number of eligible non-college educated white voters, of which he's done well with, particularly men. There are many of them, over 1 million of them in Michigan, who did not vote in the 2016 election. Equal numbers in Pennsylvania, more in Pennsylvania, and almost 1 million in Wisconsin. He's going to have to have registered those folks by the deadline and turn them out. That would be the his probably his best chance at closing the gap at this point.
Matt, I'll give you the last word. Donald Trump, shirts on fire, backs against the wall, bill collectors at the door. What's he do?
Well, the problem, Byron, is that 2 weeks ago before the last debate, if this is a marathon and presidential races are marathons, he was 7 miles behind 2 weeks ago before that debate. Now he's 10 miles behind. So he's not only not gaining ground, he's losing ground in this race. And so at this point, the only thing he can do is hope for a mistake, which is, I think, one of the fundamental things that by Biden, that hope for a fundamental mistake in this race that puts Biden down and knocks Biden down a few points. And he has to change the fundamental nature of the electorate, different than what we think it is today. Fundamentally change that electorate. And I would say it's not, he doesn't have 19 days. The election ends in 19 days. Because 18 million people have already voted, and by next week, 25 million people will already voted. So he has less time than you think, because this election is going to be basically decided by the Friday before the last day of voting, because two-thirds of people will have voted by that Friday.
Thank you all. That's all of our Powerhouse Roundtable tonight. Keep it right here on ABC News Live. Coming up next, an encore of tonight's Town Hall with Joe Biden. Thanks for joining us. Good night.
It's being called the most consequential election of a lifetime.